This episode of an unexpected podcast is dedicated to Winnie Sue, turning 3 this week. Time flies. We love you, baby. All by myself. Don't want to zoom all by myself.
Hey, buddy.
Hey, you ready to go?
I thought I was gonna have to do this alone.
I'm glad you're here.
Nah, dude, I don't think so, man. I just got done. What? I just got done talking that Mando season finale, you know,
oh.
and I'm feeling man done.
I'm sure you are. I haven't seen the finale, but I've heard it's quite a finale. Why don't you grab a cup?
You know,
get some Dr. Bean coffee in you.
Dude, I don't have a coffee machine man thing guy, really? Dude. I don't have one. So,
well, I haven't seen the finale, but I saw Star Wars Weathertop, and I observed a little green guy doing something. I'm gonna try. Let me see if this works. Let's just see if this works. All right.
Okay. All right. Sure.
Here we go. All right. You gotta be kidding me.
Oh my.
That worked?
You are strong in the ways of the Force. Let me try this here real quick.
Hopefully it made the jump to light speed okay.
Oh my gosh. It's a little cold, honestly, coming up, you know. Okay. But we'll work on that.
Space is cold. It's very, very cold.
I get that. Wow, this is good though. Just think of what it can make me do. As in, get juiced for this episode.
Yeah, baby.
Right? Go get some of your own at drbeancoffeecompany.com.
It is the only roast. It is the only roast. Sorry, that force.
It took everything out of me.
Took a lot out of me.
Everything out of it.
It's the only roast for the brave and toast. I don't know. Could you pass the cup?
You're starting to sound like me, my good friend. You're starting
you
to sound like
back?
Me. Yeah, yeah. Dun 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 dun. Wow! All you have to do is sing the Star Wars theme, and it comes through.
And it's warm.
That's awesome. Wow. Wow, that was all me. That was all me. So
that was all you. You heated it back up.
Dude, I think I'm. I am losing you.
Seriously, you're faking a breakup?
Oh, sorry.
Get that coffee in you. Let's podcast. It's time to go. Dr. Bean Coffee Company gets you ready to go. Go get some now. You can podcast like a rock star.
People far below are sleeping as we fly. I'm holding very tight. I'm riding in the midnight blue. I'm finding I can fly so high above with you.
Hello, friends, and welcome to an unexpected podcast. I'm Ez.
And I'm Lane.
And we're talking Tolkien.
We're coming to you from the Shire of America, the beautiful state of Ohio, in a little village called Amanda.
This week, we find ourselves in a strange stay. Was that a werebear? Did you hear a neigh? Is that a dog serving food from a tray? How's it standing that way as we enter into the House of Bjorn in Chapter 7, Queer Lodgings? That is honestly one of the best intros you have ever written for me.
I'm not sipping on mead, which would be very fitting.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I'm cracking open something, and this is going to be a better visual illusion than it is an audio, but see how big this thing is?
Holy smokes.
Write the theme tune, sing the theme tune. So if so in the House of Beorn, in some behind the scenes, Martin Freeman is sitting in one of the chairs. He's very small, obviously. He's a human. The chairs are oversized. The mugs are oversized. The cans of beer would be oversized. And he makes an allusion to a skit from Little Britain. Write the theme tune, sing the theme tune, la 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 la. So any of our listeners over the pond or uppers who might like the show Little Britain will get that one. This, my friend, is a crowler.
Okay.
Which is a can, it's a can growler. And I want to give a huge shout out since we're getting ready for Christmas time. Very special. I'm not drinking mead, but dude, this stuff right here from Double Edge Brewery.
Wow.
It's Christmas cookie. It's a Christmas cookie beer. And I thought it was a sham. It tastes just like Christmas cookie. So we're here together. We're getting ready for the holidays. It's Winnie's birthday tomorrow.
Yeah. God, I love her.
It's just, it's good. We're coming up on 3 years of podcasting in Middle Earth. Yeah. It's good times, man. It's just like, but it does feel kind of queer, doesn't it?
Yeah,
it feels kind of strange. We were just talking about how weird, you were saying how weird it feels that you've only known Winnie 3 years, that we've only been doing this.
Yeah.
It seems longer in a lot of ways, you know?
Yeah, yeah, it really does.
We're living in a strange, you know, I don't know, man. It's wild. It's wild to think about all that's transpired in such a short amount of time.
Yeah, it really is. And it just nothing seems right. I mean, it's I call it a little bit queer that we're honestly podcasting from afar.
We're back. Yep.
We are back to the Zoom call. So if things sound a little bit different or things a little awkward or delayed or whatever, look, that is what
we're awkward guys, you know?
When you get awkward. So we are awkward guys. That is so true. People know that. So we're doing this over Zoom. It's so crazy because I love that we have the visual though, because I can see, actually, when I look at Lane, he probably feels really off put. First of all, because my whole shot's whopper jaw, and I'll explain that in a second. I had to improv real quick, real fast. But his shot looks the same to me. I'm used to seeing that backdrop.
Well, your backdrop is different, but your head's about in the same place.
Because I've got about you on that word for a second. Backdrop. Go ahead.
Backdrop. Are you talking about your LBPT again?
Sometimes it falls right out the back of my shirt. Oh man. No matter how much
you know Beorn has a lower back ponytail.
You know
100%. That's the bear that don't transform. That stays the same whether he's a man or he's a bear.
That's right. Oh, Beorn, dude. Oh my gosh.
We're back to doing it remotely. We, you know, things are here in Ohio, man, and I'm sure probably where you are too. Stuff's just kind of spreading like crazy, and we thought to ourselves to help keep everybody safe and protect our loved ones. For a long time, I think we thought like we'll be in school, both of us will be teaching, so whatever one of us is going to get, the other one's going to get. And then we realized within the last month, we're like, just because we're in schools doesn't mean they're the same schools. And us probably seeing each other might not even be the wisest thing right now either. So we just thought, to err on the side of caution and safety, and that we can still podcast this way. It's not like, it's not my favorite way to do it, but honestly, it's sort of like bringing back memories now, because anytime we do this, it's usually for YouTube videos for the show, or like way back when we filled that gap in Return of the King, where we did like 4 or 5 episodes this way. So honestly, and that's actually why we're a week later, and we were supposed to be doing this episode with Kurt Jones as well.
Yeah.
You know, last episode, it was we were supposed to be with Max in Paragraphs. This week, We were supposed to have Kurt Jones up here in the Shire. And next week we were going to have, or next episode, we were going to have Joe Lewis out. And so, yeah, it's just changed things. It's changed things, but it's nice that we can do it this way. And honestly, dude, the biggest thing, I reached out to Kurt. All right. I don't think Kurt will mind me talking about this because, I mean, who doesn't love Kurt Jones? And I was just like, dude, I was like, Kurt, here's what's going on, man. I was like, you know, because you always gauge people like how worried they are, how cautious they are.
That's
like,
right.
You know, you don't want to assume anything, but at the same time, you don't want to offend anybody. So you're like, hey, man, I was like, what, you know, how are you feeling? And we ended up having this conversation. And I was like, are you more looking forward to this chapter or were you just wanting to hang out with us? And I always like in the back of my mind think like, yeah, I'm sure that our friends would enjoy hanging out with us, but it's probably more about, you know, queer lodgings for Kurt. It's probably more about flies and spiders for Joe. It was probably more about whatever last chapter was for Max, you know,
climbing out of the mountain.
Right. Yeah. That's it. But Kurt's like, honestly, man, I was looking forward to spending time with y'all.
Yeah. And that's why I love that guy.
And it just, I was like, wow, dude, it just, and that's what you hope to hear back, but you don't want to assume like, you know, I don't want to assume that Kurt's looking forward to seeing us that much. Cause I'm looking forward to seeing him, but I don't want to assume that of him, you know, towards us.
Been talking about it for months. You and I've been talking about it for months.
I know. Like just to see him again and to hear his voice and get to talk to him in person, you know, was something we were really highly anticipating. But just to hear that it's like, man, it's more about just seeing you guys. I was like, wow. Yeah. I said, so how about this? How about we postpone it to later in the book when hopefully in the spring or summer or whatever things are more manageable and it's not as risky to get together. And he said, hey, man, that sounds good to me. So anyway, huge shout out to Kurt. Huge shout out to Max and also to Joe for being flexible. Mike Charles is also going to be coming on a chapter. And because I asked, I said, would you want to come on Zoom? And they're like, we'd rather just, you know, hang out in person. So
yeah, you're right.
Huge shout out to them for being flexible and also just, you know, understanding and everything. But man, I can't wait to, that is the one bummer, you know, because we were looking forward to holiday time, having these people over to our house, spending time with them and talking Tolkien. But, you know, it's just one more thing, I guess, to look forward to when things are a little more safe. So,
well, look, man, here's the thing. Look, Mirkwood is just, I see it. All right. We're about to enter it. We've been driving toward, Lane, sometimes I hesitate and I drop something and Lane goes, Ez has no idea where he's going with that thought. And I actually did. I just was trying to think of the word, the name Mirkwood for a split second. I almost said Misty Mountains. I said, we're way past those. I don't know what's going on here. Anyways, I was trying to tie it back into real life, which is you see those. Yes. We have a ways to go. We get through. But don't worry, friends. We're going to get on the other side of that. We'll see the Lonely Mountain.
That's a great comparison. We'll, I mean, honestly, because you think about it, I was thinking about this chapter. The two main things, not a lot happens in this chapter, right? I guess you could say, except we get to explore a wild character in Beorn.
Yeah.
And we come to the realization that Gandalf is not on this adventure. He's made allusions in the past to it, but he's for real. This is not his quest. He's got other business. No. And maybe I'll see you again. Maybe I won't. And that's a scary realization for, you know, even the staunchest of dwarves. And so, yeah, that is kind of a, and they're about to head into a very dark place that they're warned several times to stay on the path. And if they don't, they'll probably never be seen again. Yeah, it's a similar situation that we find ourselves in, I think.
Well, isn't that the thing? Let's not even just talk about Corona.
This tastes so much. I think there's Christmas cookies like in the bottom of this, dude.
Well, I'm honestly,
I wish you could taste this, but it would kick you out of ketosis just sniffing it.
Something's wrong right now because I feel like I'm swelling up a little bit because something's coming through these ears and it's seeping down into my beard, which I'm then... Every time I lick, you know, I'm feeling like a little cookie, and I don't know if that's coming from the ear. You know what I'm saying?
I know what you mean.
Weird things are happening here on the audio. Yeah.
Queer recordings.
That's where we're at right now. Yeah, could not have picked the better chapter to start off on this whole setup. So this is great. Oh, it's great. Let me just explain if folks are wondering why Ez sounds a little fuzzy, and why if you're looking at the visual and you're wondering why is Ez's shot so jacked up? Let me explain this real quick. I told Lane I would do this, and I think he's really nervous. I think he's really pitting out right now as to what I'm gonna say. By pitting out, I mean like his pits,
yeah,
armpits are profusely sweating.
Because, you know, yeah, this is one of those crazy asides, man. But I made a switch recently in the armpit department.
Yeah.
Remind me to tell you off air because it's changed my life. As
well, I think you've actually told me.
Have I told you about this?
Oh, dude, let me tell you right now.
Okay, that's cool. Wow, that's nice.
I know about all natural.
Way to embarrass me. Way to embarrass me on
all natural products.
Okay, all right.
That's not embarrassing. So
the reason I'm pitting out.
Yeah. The reason you're pitting out is because I'm going to tell you this story. So the reason.
Right, yeah.
So I was talking Mando, as we said in the commercial, and I was talking about the season finale, and I'm going to try to get Lane's thoughts on that soon. I'm going to definitely get him on the Seeing Stone. I want to talk to him about a few things.
Can we also just say how cool it is that, like, Star Wars has a weather top now.
Oh, that's what I was going to talk. That's one of the things I wanted to talk to you about.
Star Wars has a weather top, down to the ring wraiths.
Yep. There's one more thing I want. Like, when you watch the season finale, you're going to be like, "Yep, I know what Ez wants." When you think Lord of the Rings and
really,
you're going to think of one more thing, possibly, maybe. If not, I'll surprise you with it, and it's going to be great. But anyway, so we're gonna talk about that. So I was watching watch that. I had my last day of school. We're gonna have winter break. We're going on that. So that'll be fun. But I came back here and so over quarantine, I want to tell folks, first of all, thank you to everyone who Lane is so nervous right now. Thank you to everyone who sent me a message. Whether it be on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, wherever it may be, you can follow me at womprat_2m. I love hearing from you guys. I do enjoy conversing, but at the same time, after quarantine, once I got back into school, I had to detox a little from social media, come back to it. And I realized it's okay to do that. I realized it's okay to like step away for a little bit and then come back. And I have my own reasons for going back and going away and things like that. But honestly, I was shocked at how good that it felt to kind of do that and to make a change in your life and not just keep doing the same thing over and over and over. Sometimes you got to mix it up, just like in your workout routine or whatever you're doing. Sometimes it's good to mix that up. I don't know. That's just where I'm at, but
yes.
So the other thing was though, over quarantine, Ez was living this secret life of going to comedy shows on Zoom. I was going to Zoom comedy shows and met a friend. And so this friend hit me up tonight and said, like, "Hey, I'm hosting this thing." And I was like, "Oh, sure. I'll pop in there. No problem." And I'm embarrassed to say I would turn the camera. But this stack of White Claws sitting over here will tell you how much fun I had at that comedy show, man. It probably, like, it was such a good time because, like, you think about quarantine, it's such a weird time for us, right? It's such a weird time. Yeah. I actually legitimately made friends during that time period. I kind of like disconnected from any group that I knew, right? Like no podcasting group, no whatever. Yeah. This is a group of people that have no idea that I run a podcast. They have no idea who I am. They don't even know that I'm a teacher.
They don't know you're famous, right? Is that what you're getting at?
That's it.
Come on, that's it.
Dave calls the emperor of podcasting. I don't call it that.
So hold on. So this is kind of like... guy. The Christmas cookie is going right through me.
It's going right through you.
These Zoom comedy clubs are kind of like your celebrity sunglasses. That's what they are.
I guess so. Maybe.
They are.
Maybe. But it's fantastic. And they're honestly hilarious.
They're
comedians, though, who are like legit really good, and they don't have anywhere to go perform.
The clubs are shut down, man. The comedy clubs are shut down.
Here's the thing. Yeah. I think about, like, I love running our podcast. I love doing YouTube and things like that. And I really appreciate every single person who supports us on Patreon and helps us out.
Yeah.
Like, I cannot thank you guys enough. Lane and I, it just makes, God, we sent out the gift packages. I'm so happy about that. I was thrilled. I'm pumped about the Zoom chats that we do. It's so much fun. And it's just such a cool thing. We're blessed to be able to do that. So I was like, you know what? These guys are out here. They can't go to the bar. So I'm going to go in here to these Zoom chats, and I met all these comedians who are now think I'm, like, because I'm a good laugher. Just sorry to brag a little bit, but, like,
you're a great audience.
I like laughing.
I can attest to that.
I like laughing at stuff. And so they were like, and I didn't know that was a skill, but they were like, please, they were like, please come back, because, like, you sit in Zoom things and you just, like, do this, like, laugh, and, like, you don't stop laughing. I'm like, well, I thought that's what you're funny. You're funny. And they're like, well, not everybody thinks we are. And like, so then I'm realizing I just kind of laugh at everything. I'm just a guy who laughs at everything. And that's fine. That's fine.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, well, no, sorry. I only laugh at Lane when he's actually,
I was
going to
say, wow, I'm
which
now
is
questioning
all the time,
my actual level of humor there. That's a humbling experience.
Oh,
sorry. Back to your White Claws, though. Like, I think we were definitely having a Gandalf and Beorn moment where you were like, I was like, you're one. Two. Oh, you call two, one.
Oh, that's
you call
true.
Five, a few.
That's true.
Like, the cans just kept coming, dude. I was like, hey,
Lane right. didn't believe me.
Now,
he didn't believe
now,
me.
Now, what is the real number here? Yeah,
I know. And just in case anybody does check on the show, and you guys watch the visual here, and you notice that I'm a little bit more pale than I normally am. It's just the white light. It's not the fact that I almost tore off a fingernail and bled out over here. Trying to open a can.
That is recorded, though. We have that recorded.
I did record that.
Be a nice little cold opening. Hey, do you want to shout out any of these comedians? Plug any of these comedians? Or, like, can anyone go to these Zooms?
Yeah, honestly. And I can leave, like, a link to some of that in the description.
Yeah,
because,
that'd be great.
Yeah,
share,
like,
the love.
Like, there are some really cool things that you can do. Okay, ironically, I this is no joke. Ironically, I was in there today. And my friend, she messaged me and she said, hey, I would just be nice. I don't know who's going to be in the Zoom chat. It'd be nice to see your face. It'd be nice for you to pop in there and laugh if you can. No one else can make it. Can you make it? And it was at 8:00. And I was like, well, Lane and I are getting on around 9:30. It's typically, you know, I'll just see. I'll see how long this goes and I'll pop in. So I pop in there and lo and behold, so people all around the country are trying to do what we're trying to do, which is like, okay, the vaccine's coming. We're getting close to it. So let's just calm down a second. Let's just chill out and try to, like, if there was ever a time to really say, all right, let's just be good about this. Like, at school, I know for a fact, like, we've been told, like, you know, look, you've been cleaning desks this whole time. Don't stop now. Like, God, for God's sake, don't stop now. Just keep doing it. And we're almost there. Yeah. So I get in there. There are like 25 teachers from Wisconsin in this chat that my friend didn't know, that nobody else knew. We get in there. There are teachers who literally just said, we want to do something as a group. They just picked some random event that they found online.
That is crazy.
They went to like Bright Event or Eventbrite or whatever it's called. Like, it's the ticket thing. You can like search events in your area or I don't know. And they found their event. Got on there and they started supporting these comedians and they're like, raise your hand if you're a teacher. And I was just like, I didn't know they were all teachers. And I like go to raise my hand and I'm like, oh shoot, there's 30 people in here. Am I in the wrong spot? Like, what is going on?
Do you think it was a PD or something?
I was like, professional development's taking place. Oh, I was like, that got it. I don't have a notepad or anything. It was like a nightmare. You know, you woke up, you're like,
do I
oh crap.
Credit for a dish?
Or? Am I getting CEOs or CEUs? What do they call it? Wow. I'm really gone. I'm gone. It's so
something like that. Yeah.
Something like that. Some hours. So anyways, it was really cool though. And I was like, this is neat. And they started messaging me in Zoom and it was just kind of funny. And so I was like, well, let's have fun with this. I'm in for the long haul. And I sat down, I met some teachers. This one guy was just like, it was hilarious. We were talking about English and what you teach and talking about the books we read at the high school level versus middle school level the whole time we're doing this while a comedy show is going on. And it was a lot of fun.
That's awesome, dude.
Yeah, it was different. It was a mix up, and it's a guy I'll probably never see again in my life. But you know, it reminded me of going to like a concert or going
convention
to
or something.
Yeah, whatever it might be, running across that person, having a genuinely good conversation, and saying, "All right, that was fun. I'll remember that." And odds are, that's that. You know, I'll never see that guy again. But it was cool. It was really good, and memorable. So
yeah,
you know,
that's awesome, dude.
I know. I just wanted to share that. You know, for people. So. Yeah.
But it's amazing how technology has, you know, I don't know. It's human beings are definitely creative and ingenious little creatures, aren't we? Like, we find ways to make the best of situations that, you know, could be pretty crummy and are still most of the time, but we find ways around it. We adapt and we overcome. And yeah, things like that, you know, just bringing laughter, having conversations, and when those, you know, would be much harder to have in any other capacity right now. So yeah, but you're doing good, man. Like,
yeah, man, I'm honestly doing good. I feel good. I have to, one more thing to do. I'm kind of, I still proctor the ACT, so I'm giving that bad boy and
couple extra $100 baby in the paco.
Yeah, I like that. I like giving the ACT.
I wish there was an equivalent of that for elementary, because that'd be a nice way to make a couple extra bucks. You know what I mean? Like,
it is crazy. I always feel bad when I proctor the ACT, because it's the one time as a teacher I'm sitting there going, like, I feel like that teacher in the movie who has the newspaper, and it's just like, let me know when you guys are done. Like, let me know when you're finished.
Step up from Breakfast Club.
Yeah, I'm like, I feel kind of like I shouldn't be getting paid for this, but okay, all right, I'll do it.
No, Dad, what about you?
Yeah. So, anyways, hey, are you guys doing okay over there?
Yeah, dude.
I feel it's awkward. I haven't had a chance to come over there and, you know, say hey.
Why
is it,
if it's awkward, it's only awkward for you. We just miss you.
I miss you, man. I mean,
that was part of the reason I think I already talked about this. This Christmas cookie is half a can of this is 32 ounces.
Watch out now. This is going to turn into the Brewmaster episode if we're not careful.
Lord, I know. Ben, where are you, buddy?
Ben doesn't come back. Ben, we're going to have to bring him back.
Ben's going to be back. Ben would love this beer. Anyway, yes, things are wonderful. On Christmas break, I got done with my final Zoom today. And I yelled, I'm in my own little room. It's the old teacher, one of the old teacher lounges that has there's like an actual microwave and mini fridge and freezer in my classroom. So no one's ever there. I don't see anybody all day long unless I get out and when I go to recess duty, I see people. But so it's been a very isolating year. And legit, it felt like an accomplishment just to make it to Christmas break. It felt like an accomplishment. And, you know, like, our community has not been immune to what's going on with the spread and the coronavirus. So, you know, there are people, teachers and kids who have gotten sick and have been out. And so it's there. You know what I mean? It's like, it's there. And it's one of those things that you think about. Like, it's, you go every day to a play. I'm not working from home. I'm in my school, even though my students aren't with me in person. Yeah. I'm still there. And, but just the mental drain of teaching on Zoom all day with, you know, a class of 25, 26 kids that you have to mute, because can you imagine if you didn't, just the background noise and talking. Mm. So when I teach a lesson, it's like 20 minutes, 30 minutes straight of me just talking and interacting with chat and through like raising hands and unmuting one at a time. But it's just so different. You got to bring a different energy to the point where in between Zooms, you're like recovering. You have to do something mindless, because it just takes more out of you than a normal lesson would.
Yeah.
So we got done with the final Zoom, and I think I screamed out, like, well, I texted Sarah, I can't remember. I was like, yeah, made it, baby. Like, I just screamed out, like, made it to Christmas break. It just feels like an accomplishment. I don't know. I know it sounds ridiculous, but it feels like, okay, all right. Every milestone this year, it feels so much bigger, because you're hoping that, I hope like next year is back to normal.
Yeah.
And the year after that is back to normal. And
I know.
You know, there are aspects of this year that have been easier, but I don't know. Just, I feel like things that should be simple are so much more difficult than they should be. Yes.
Well, so I raised.
Yes, Mr. Kirk, go ahead.
I raised my hand there.
Let me unmute you, buddy. Okay. Go ahead.
And I know folks already know this, and Kurt knows this. Kurt Jones knows this with his children, and a lot of folks out there understand this. So my niece, man, I thought about like her age, and I thought about the kids that you and Sarah are teaching online, and like the click to raise your hand and the unmute yourself and the technical things you have to do just in that for little kids. Now, my niece is in kindergarten, but still, I can't imagine. And some of the stuff we've had to do online with her, I'm like, it actually does break my heart, man. It totally, like, it is not what is good for kids. It's not, it totally sucks. And I wish it weren't that way. Like, it hurts, and I see it. And I go home to my niece, and I literally, she wants me, and she's totally cool with letting me, like, teach her, like, numbers and counting and teaching her letters. And it's like, and I know all those parents are out there doing that extra stuff, and I, God bless them, and God bless you for doing, because, dude, I just cannot imagine, man. Like, I do hybrid. So I have kids who come into my room and kids who are on Zoom as well. And wow, the difference, the drain that I feel, I am like, I just so wish those kids were in here and I could hand them a piece of paper and we could work on stuff and do note cards. The whole barrier, it's a whole nother thing, man. So I think,
don't you think too, like as teachers, you, even if you feel like garbage in a day, you can have those moments where, like, the aha moments where kids get something or you feel like you actually made progress on something with a one student, a group of students, an entire class. And it like, fires you up, dude. Like, that's the reason we became teachers.
Yeah.
It fires you up. And I'm in this model, I'm missing those experiences. I don't know if it's impossible, but I haven't figured out how to do it yet. And the motivation and the drive to figure out how to do it is it's small. So it is kind of it feels nice to be on break. It feels like it is actually an accomplishment that I've made it without losing my mind.
Yep.
And it's, you know, we're really excited for break for Christmas. Winnie's birthday is tomorrow, 3 years old. We had a party at my mom and dad's, tonight. My mom, watches the girls and my niece as well. My sister Hillary and, my brother-in-law Darrell's daughter. And so she watches all the girls. So they're, you know, we see them every day anyway. So we figured we could have a little party.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so mom made Winnie is obsessed with The Snowy Day by Ezra Jack Keats. There's a prime like animated version now, and she watches it and is obsessed with Peter and the snowballs and the snowy day and the mac and cheese and going to Nana's house. And it's so cool. It's like, you know, it's very true to the book, but it's a really short picture book. So they elaborate on it. But she's like, she'll watch it with the book and she'll go, that's not in. Why is Nana not in the book, Daddy? Why is Nana not in the book? Like having these, dude, 3 year old having these.
Like,
this girl is already like five grades ahead of me. She's nuts. She's nuts. So anyway, so my mom made mac and cheese because it's Granny making mac and cheese, you know, and it's something that happens in this movie. She got such thoughtful, wonderful presents. I told you she got these gifts, and she was just literally like. Like Winnie is not, it doesn't, there's, it's rare when she can't process stuff. She's very quick at processing and just rolling with things. And she was overwhelmed with like everyone nailed the gifts and she was just sitting there holding them just like,
what do I do?
She wanted to sleep with all of them. And like, this is the first, I mean, parents out there, you can relate if you've got kids who've hit this, like this age where they, like birthdays and holidays become meaningful. And to this point, they haven't really been like, Winnie didn't really understand it fully last year. It was still like, she was still baby enough, but she's old enough now that it's like, she was anticipating her birthday. We've been counting down for like a month, all week. It was her birthday week.
Yeah.
She was looking forward to this party. She's looking forward to Christmas. Charlotte's getting a little bit of that, not as much as Winnie yet. Next year will be Charlotte's like big, you know, realization of all that stuff. So it's just, I don't know, all that to say, it's just so magical to enter this time with that excitement. I haven't had that for a long, long time, dude. And then just to try and like find meaningful gifts for her that will, and Charlotte, and I mean Ruth is so chill. It doesn't matter. Like, it could be Christmas or we could be in a world war and she'd just be sitting here like this.
Uh-huh. Yep.
She's the chillest baby ever. Like, even for a baby, she's just like, whatever, guys. I'm good. Like, do what you gotta do.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I'm looking forward to break. I'm looking forward to, you know, doing our anniversary episode. And man, just I ordered a couple books. If you want full insight to my life right now, I ordered The Message, which is like a version, a modern language version of the Bible, because I thought I wanted to give that a shot. And I actually ordered, this would be great for Nicole Whitaker, because she was the one who told me about this series. I ordered The Gunslinger, so the Dark Tower series,
which
is Stephen King's homage to Lord of the Rings. So I'm going to try and read that over the next couple weeks. And I'm actually writing again, Ez.
Really?
I'm back in writing the fairy tale, and I'm feeling very inspired. And so that's awesome. Trying to get that done for the girls before they're 30, you know. So it's not for the grandkids. It's for, you know, them, actually. but, yeah, no, I'm loving it, man. I'm excited to be here. I'm glad we're doing it this way and continuing to crank on. And there's actually a Tolkien story about this later. But, you know, we had a, if I can be frank, we had a conversation. And I was just like, dude, what, you know what? I was like, what is the point?
Mm-hmm.
I was like, guys, what's the point, man? And I've had times where I felt very low myself.
Yep.
And I'm like, why? Like, who cares? Record or not, who cares?
Yep.
And we've gotten some letters recently from people who have really shown me that if we provide nothing else than a couple of laughs or a little bit of an escape, that it does mean something to at least a few people. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I was like, that is enough.
Yeah.
That's enough for me to, yeah, you know what? Stay up late one night every couple weeks, be exhausted. That, like, all that is worth it. When I hear people's stories, I think if we're any kind of part of that in a small way, and we can help by just continuing doing what we enjoy doing anyway. It's an honor, man. It's an honor. It really is an honor. So
is.
I'm glad that we're doing it this way.
Yeah. I'm with you, man. I'm with you 100%.
Yeah. All right. Longest quick counsel ever.
I love it.
Dropping eaves. We are getting into, we're going to be recording a whole slew of videos. Our most recent one is Ezra's White Claws. But there is a whole new batch of actors and actresses that have been cast.
Yeah.
Another, like, I want to say 20. So if you go to Loader on Prime on Instagram, there are, like, legit, I think maybe 20 headshots, and a list of names of new actors and actresses that have been cast. My guess is they're going to be featured prominently in season 2, because I haven't heard much, man. They are keeping this thing. The lid is on tight, and that's the way I like it.
Right.
So we're going to speculate as much as we can. Now, there was one announcement from this last batch that has me really, really excited. Peter Mullen, who is from, I first remember seeing him in Braveheart. He utters the famous line, "All right, lads, I'm not dying for these bastards."
Yeah, yeah.
And then off they go. And then you see him again later in the movie. But he is also, my favorite film he's in is On a Clear Day. And he's in that with Billy Boyd, actually. It's a beautiful movie about a man who swims the English Channel.
Right.
He's laid off and then sets this goal for himself to swim the English. And there's all this sub story with the son. And a son he lost, actually. And then he was also in Top of the Lake, which is it was a miniseries that was set in New Zealand, filmed in New Zealand, and David Wenham was in that as well. So Peter Mullen is he's one of those guys, you recognize his face, you recognize his voice, you wouldn't know his name. But the fact that he's in this show, I'm beside myself. Like, that's probably the most exciting announcement I've heard so far, because this dude, whatever he's in, he elevates it. He's a fantastic actor. He can play a really, really good guy, a really, really bad guy, or anything in between.
Right.
He is one of those dudes. I have to show you Top of the Lake, and specifically his performance in Top of the Lake, because he is so compelling to watch. And I just think if he is because he's the only one I've really seen in any kind of length of all the actors and actresses that have been cast, if he's any indication of the standard that they're setting for their actors and actresses, bro, we're going to be blown away. So we're going to be speculating about that. We even have some, you know, obviously we're going to continue with the first crop of casting who we think, you know, these actors and actresses are going to
You blew
play.
Me away. So blew me away.
Our next one that will be coming out will probably be Emma Horvath. I've got a theory about her. I know Ez is going to have a couple theories and about her character or who she's going to be playing. And then we'll talk about the new actors. We'll talk about progress with the show, what we think is going to happen. So all that coming on YouTube.
We'll be quoting our sources too, just so you guys know.
Yeah, we the professor and the clickbaiters and Tom Shipley. In other did I go too far?
I love it.
Cheers to all of them.
Cheers, guys. Happy holidays. Happy holidays.
And merry, merry Christmas. And merry Pippin. In other corners of Middle Earth, so I want to give a huge shout out to the Amanda Post Office. Yeah. The true Bywater Post. Sierra and Lois and all of those wonderful workers at the Amanda Post Office. If you are a patron and you got your care package, it's because they were busting their butts. I went in with the intention of, and we had what I have, like 50 some packages to send out. As?
Yeah. Oh my God. Yeah.
I think it was like 50 to 60, I want to say.
Yeah.
I was like, dude, I'm going to have to. And our post office opens after we get to work. So we're already into Lancaster and closes before we get home. So I was like, geez, I'm going to have to spread this out on Saturdays or go into Lancaster. And the Lancaster post office, not so nice.
No, they would have been pissed. Yeah.
Oh, they are grumpy sure. as crap. So I went into Amanda with a few packages. I'm like, I'm going to have to do this. It's going to be like February before everyone gets their package. I'm going to go five at a time, whatever. I went in with five and I said, I have like, and it was great. I was like, wow, this was pretty easy. I was like, I have like 55 more of these. Should I just, you know, spread them out and go to Lancaster? Should I bring a few in here at a time? And Sierra said, just bring them all in now. I was like, what? Like today? She goes, yeah. No problem. We don't mind. She was like, don't take them to Lancaster. I was like, well, they're really grumpy there. She's like, I know. Don't take them. I said, okay. All right. I'll be back in. I planned on going back in the afternoon. I went and got the rest of them, came right back, got them all done before lunchtime. It literally took only 40 minutes to get all those packages processed with like five or six international, which take about five minutes a piece.
Yep.
They were fantastic. So a huge shout out to them. If you got your stuff or when you get your stuff, give a huge thanks to them. Really, really cool. Something that's happening that I didn't even know was happening until Sarah drew my attention to it. Their Goldberry, man, her ears are to the ground.
Yeah.
Especially since I'm not on social media now. I don't know what's going on. I'm truly a hobbit. There are going to be 4K versions of The Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit that are being released. Peter Jackson has been working hard to... It's really, really interesting. There's actually some really cool videos I have tagged in the doc that you should check out.
Yeah.
He talks about the process of going back and... so the reassuring thing is that these aren't, there's no new special effects or anything like that. I know a lot of, especially people who are Star Wars fans can relate to that frustration of having, additional, special effects put in that feel out of place, out of time, that's changed the story in a way that maybe isn't most desirable or add stuff that seems frivolous. So he was very clear about it was like a subtle allusion to that. Like, hey, these aren't new special effects. What they've done a lot of is gone in and finessed their color grading to make places and even trilogy to trilogy match in terms of like tone and color and clarity. So this is really cool. It's something he's actually been working on himself. This is something Peter Jackson has set aside time to take care of and tighten up. So he says, hopefully by the time, you know, you get these 4K versions, that when you all of his work, if his all of his work has truly paid off, will be that you can sit and watch all three Hobbits, all three Lord of the Rings, and you know, Rivendell will feel like Rivendell. And, you know, the Trollshaw will feel like the Trollshaw. And everything that is in both of those series will match. That's what he was very particular about, going in and making sure that they match and just making sure that everything looks as modern as possible. So that's really, really exciting. You know, another addition for us to have. So look, I think that's coming out soon, like beginning of the year, actually.
Oh, really?
I believe so. Double check me on that.
Yeah.
If you want to fact check me, but it's coming soon. Let's say that.
Well, this is fact check lane on just well, but yeah. Sure,
thanks for leaving me hanging there.
Beginning of the year, sometime.
I was hoping you'd do that.
Hey, no. So what I wanted to bring up here. So
There's so much distance between us.
I had a buddy who was talking about 4K and like, oh yeah, you could just take this image and it's my buddy Matt. Take this image and you just upload it to this 4K converter and it just converts it. You know, high 4K photo definition stuff, right?
Okay.
So really, Peter Jackson, oh yeah, it's this, right? So you didn't just upload your video to some 4K. Come on, man.
I mean, okay, so I get
how
like,
hard
I love,
was it, Lane?
I love Matt, but if I'm gonna trust someone on filmmaking, I think I'm going with Peter Jackson, Matt. I'm sorry, man.
Oh no, yeah.
I think I'm gonna take my boy PJ's word for it.
He'd be so mad because he was only talking about images and pictures, and I.
Well,
I was
and saying, so maybe that's true, but the color correction that has nothing to do with image quality. He's going in and. Because this is also very interesting. I didn't realize this. For Fellowship of the Ring, they color coded it differently than, or not color, color graded it. Color grading is something that has come a long way just in like our lifetime, since we were in college, actually. Remember when I had Final Cut Pro?
Oh, yeah.
That had full color grading. So this was something that used to be done on film, and it took forever. And then they found a way to do it digitally. So essentially what you could do is you could totally change the composition, the color and lighting composition of a scene without having to worry about it while you're filming. It was like revolutionary. Yeah. But Fellowship of the Ring was done on film. The other two in the Lord of the Rings were done digitally color graded. So even those in the trilogy didn't fully match originally. And then, of course, with The Hobbit, it was done. There were so many different techniques that were used. Plus, you had the 3D, the different frame rate, all this stuff. So going back and making sure that it all matches and updating all that stuff. So,
Lane, don't tell me that. What I know is they went to a place called Middle Earth, and they took out their cameras, and they just
recorded,
filmed the events that took place.
It happened.
There, so,
it happened
cool
in front
with.
Of them. I know. That's pretty awesome. Amazing.
Yeah.
And one last thing, I do have a little tease. This is very exciting. I haven't even told you about this.
No.
Yet. This is something that was actually formulated and hatched today. So, of course, you know, you have the beautiful sipping. Don't forget the sipping with Dr. Bean Coffee, right? You can go get a signature up blend and then all the wonderful other blends that Dr. Bean Coffee has. I think my favorite is the Frankenstein blend.
Yeah.
It is incredible. So go check that out. If they still have it, it's amazing. Get some. But there's another promo coming, okay? At the beginning of the year, we'll have another promo coming. All I want to say is don't ever forget the sniffing.
Yes. I'm gonna
give a little tease, fire it up.
Mm-hmm.
And just all I'm gonna say is it's an exciting collaboration and you're not gonna wanna miss it. You're gonna wanna sniff it.
Let's go. Is this guy working for a branding marketing agency yet? What's going on over here? All right.
It was, but they went out of business because it was too cheesy or dad jokey or something. That's what that was the claim.
It was too lame. Come on, somebody give me a high five for that one. That was pretty good. Oh,
that was actually what people, they used to mock me like.
Oh, I'm totally kidding, okay? Like, you know what?
All right.
People also used to mock me.
What, they call you Fezra?
They called me a lot of things.
Fezra Dork? That was pretty good, wasn't it?
Yeah, you know. Every time they called me a wizard, though, it's like, they have
no idea. Check this out. This is a bookmark. It's the original logo.
It's the original logo.
Should auction that off.
Hey, also, by the way, people who got your gift packages or whatever, you got some original stuff in there. Hopefully, they're individualized. I'll just say that. Some of them are very individualized, and so hopefully you enjoy those.
Maybe you got a little lock of
I thought they were really cool.
Lower back ponytail.
Lower back ponytail was in every freaking package, okay? We had one hair for every package, all right? Oh my gosh, I'm glad we're talking about it again.
It's been a while since we talked about the LBPT. And
oh, I know.
Maybe because it made people uncomfortable.
I feel like I've never felt somebody... Oh, gosh. We were in Dallas, and I felt like we just made so many people uncomfortable talking about it. And I said, I guess...
Katie was petrified. Yeah, she was like, really? We're still talking about this?
Time to retire it.
Katie, have you not listened to the episodes? Because this is all we talk about.
It's time to retire.
We talk about this more than we talk about the book.
Right, right. And she was like, wow. Wow. All right. Well, yeah. So now it is time to talk about the book, my friend. All right. It is time to get into Chapter 7, Queer Lodgings. And my friends, this was, as Layton said earlier, it is a pretty straightforward chapter. And not that it's not significant, because it is one of the most interesting chapters, I think. It's just very interesting. You know, it's just, Beorn is just such a really cool, interesting character. And oh, by the way, I forgot to mention, spoilers ahead. Spoilers ahead in this. As we talk about this. Oh, I mean, I'm sorry. Spoilers for the end of the freaking book. Thank you, Tolkien. Are you kidding me? I'm reading this, and he literally says to me, like, I'm reading the book, right? And I totally forgot this was in there. He was like, all right, well, and that's it for the Eagles. Oh, until the Battle of the Five Armies. What's that? Don't worry about it. We'll talk about that later. Spoiler much? Five armies are going to battle. So sorry, that was my spoiler warning for everyone.
How C.S. Lewis is that too?
Yeah,
just very C.S. Lewis
drop. Yeah, you know, I was like, that's wild, guys. So that there was that. So spoilers ahead. But really, this does go, it's a lot of time just watching Gandalf kind of do his thing. Like I'm going to kind of talk big takeaways because of all the white claws that are sitting over here. Honestly to me, it was, the Eagles are awesome. By the way, the part, let me see if I can find it really quick. So as we get into the queer lodgings here, my too long didn't read on this chapter, which is essentially like a summary, is that the Eagles take them to the Eyrie. They are looking for lodging. They find it with a skin changer, okay?
Werebear.
And then he ends up, like, taking care of them, giving them ponies, and they get across his land, you know, to Mirkwood. And that's it. That's pretty much it.
They go to Skinwalker Ranch, essentially, is what happens.
Oh, my gosh. I was going to actually do an
appendices. Beorn, he's a Skinwalker.
I was actually going to do an appendices with you on something very similar to that, so that's hilarious you bring that up. Don't let me forget to do that later.
Okay,
all right. Yeah. But no, like, in the beginning of this, I mean, the Eagles that kind of blow me away. Let's see if I can find it real quick. But, like, Bilbo is on there, is you know, they take them again. They get some food in the beginning, and if I skip anything, you want to like code it.
But it's not great stuff, though, right? I mean,
no, it's not good.
But I did think this was interesting. Sorry, no, I'm not going to stop you too much. I promise.
Oh, well, here we go.
He. I love how he brings something kind of full circle, or puts a spin on it, or twist on it, or whatever. But you know, like what they had, it was only cold mutton and rabbit, right? So only rabbit. But we've fast forward ahead to Frodo and Sam in the Two Towers, and it's like getting rabbits to eat, a brace of conies, is like a delicacy. It's unexpected. It's something that is almost like a little mini feast for them. Isn't that interesting?
Yeah.
So just that little flip on perspective, like for Bilbo in this situation, maybe it's the kind of the type of hobbit that Bilbo is as well, but like it's only mutton and rabbit.
Right,
they still had food. Like in the Two Towers, like Sam and Frodo are living off of Lembas, and they're wishing they had some kind of other. And when they finally get something that for Bilbo, it's only, you know,
right,
that it's something that is special, a delicacy. I just think that's kind of interesting how that comes to a different, you know,
well,
just
we
shows
actually-
the different type of story that the Lord of the Rings is. And
Yeah. We actually, like, it was funny because you were talking about, you had this whole theory back a few chapters ago about Hobbits and rabbits, you know, and we're not going to get back into that because it got down a whole... I had to read a test today.
Dave took it to another level,
too,
man.
Oh, my God. I had to read a test today, a biology test on mitosis and meiosis, and people will know where that's going. One of those is normal cell reproduction, and the other is not normal. I mean, it's...
atypical. Yeah.
It's, well, it's a choice. So, anyways. Yeah, you got me.
You lost me at toe.
All right. But anyways, the whole point is that like you were talking about like those rabbits and the hobbits, and then in this, like at one point Gandalf says to Bilbo when he's talking about skin changers, he talks about like the rabbits or whatever, and like skinning basically, you know, like an animal after you've killed it and you're gonna eat it. A nice coney, right?
Nice coney.
And he was like, Oh, Gandalf was like, Whoa, don't you dare bring that up around this guy here.
That's my burglar.
Oh, that was just hilarious. But yeah, no, let me back up though. So the Lord of the Eagles, this is interesting. So after they parted, I'm kind of jumping ahead here because to me, the beginning is just, okay, the Eagles, help move them to the area. And that's cool. It's more of a, we're not grabbing you with our talons. You're climbing on back. And that's a good thing. Yeah. Yeah.
No, I understand. I understand.
Oh, do you understand? Well, here's something.
Never understood more.
Here's something you should understand. All right.
You know, here's what's really cool.
Did you just cut me off?
Here's what's really cool. On page 105 in my edition.
Yeah. Back to that. Okay. Cool.
I just we're doing major takeaways, and there's a really cool like.
Do we have the same edition?
No.
Doggone it.
Well, I don't know. No, it's definitely not.
105. What paragraph?
It's 1, 2, 3, 4. He called it the Kerak because Kerak was his word for it.
Doggone it.
So anyway, I just think it's a really cool thing because it almost sounds like Tolkien talking about himself.
I
re-listened to our episode with Jim and the love of language just because I love that episode so much. I love hearing. I just talked to Jim on the phone recently. I was missing him, you know, and I was like, I just listened to that episode. And, you know, Tolkien would make words up. Like he made up the word hobbit. And I think like Beorn is a little bit Tolkien there.
Yeah.
It's the Kerak because that's what he calls it. Gandalf and Gandalf means me. It's the same kind of like, that's just what he calls it. It is that because he made the name for it. And I love that like sneaks in here.
Well,
cool.
You know, something I've noticed about authors and people who just like, whether you're writing a TV show, a movie or whatever, we kind of just buy it. Like you can kind of just tell us that something is something and we'll say, okay.
Yeah, fine.
Like, and I think more writers should do that because you could just trust the reader or whatever, the viewer or whatever, to take that. And so that's a cool thing. And actually, I'm just going to back up here real quick. The Lord of the Eagles became in after days. This is what I wanted to read. So the Lord of the Eagles became in after days the king of all birds and wore a golden crown. I don't know if you guys remember this or not. I did not remember this. Wore a golden crown and his 15 chieftains golden collars. Like this is a pretty big freaking deal. These are no slouch of eagles. These are like the eagles.
In your, to use your term, they're the tippy top.
They're the tippy top. So I was like, wow, they wore crowns. Cause like, you're actually right. Like later on in this chapter, when we're being served by walking dogs, who are and I thought back to the Eagles, I thought, dang, Tolkien, dude, oh man, you really took us on a journey, man.
A trip, if you will.
Well, and you know, I don't think we should worry so much about those beetles anymore playing next to your house. I think we need to because you were tripping on some major, this is crazy stuff here. And I love it. I love it.
Maybe, I guess this was way before he lived, was the neighbor to the young Beatles. But like, some of that residual stuff was there, you know? Like
The
smoke was leeching over, I don't know.
You hate your former self. I get it. I'm kidding. No, anyways, you were talking about the Kerak, right?
Yeah.
Where they're at. And this is the point right there at the end of that whole little passage. They begged him not to leave. They're talking about Gandalf. Gandalf basically says, hey, I'm out. Peace. I'm done. I got to move on. And that reminded me of the beginning of the book, like you said. Gandalf just has all these stories, does all these things. He's just setting up a quest. He's not going on the quest. He's not doing everything here. He has other quests he has to finish up and set up and check in on. You know, like, we don't know how many threads this guy's, you know, running. So I thought that was kind of neat. So he's basically just saying, good luck, and I'll get you some good lodging, and then we'll go from there. So he starts that. They argue with him, but it's almost like he knew it was going to be a long goodbye, and so he lays that groundwork and that foundation for them to say, hey, I'm starting the goodbye phase here, just so you know. It's a reminder, because here in a day or two, I'm going to be gone. They basically say, hey, we'll pay you in gold. We'll pay you in dragon gold. Well, look, fellas, you got to get that dragon gold first.
Right.
Okay. Right. Like, let me tell you something. There is an Arkenstone that we all ought to be a little bit more worried about than paying Gandalf, quite frankly. So, anyway.
Get that Arkenstone out of his way. Yeah. I did love, so he starts to bring up this creature, right? Or this skin changer.
Yes.
And I thought it was interesting because I don't know if there is a connection. But as Gandalf is, you know, you brought up the whole furrier thing. You know, what is he? You know, skin squirrels or whatever, and rabbits and conies. And Gandalf tells us his name before that his name is Beorn. And says, no, you know, don't be a fool, Mr. Baggins, if you can help it. And this chapter, this happens increasingly. But I want to create a term for this. I think we should call it getting Bilboned.
Right. Okay.
Bilbo owned, like he's getting owned. Yeah, like Gandalf does this time and time again. If you cannot be an idiot, that would be great. Bilboned. Like every time that happens, I think we should make a point of that. But there's also a little Gandalf redemption that where he sticks up for Bilbo. It's just this back and forth where it's like he's always keeping Bilbo on his toes, and I think that's intentional, but he talks about his origins or what he is. He changes his skin. Sometimes he is a huge black bear, talking about Beorn. Sometimes he is a great, strong, black-haired man with huge arms and a great beard. So we can visualize just this huge, like, massive, giant Viking. I cannot tell you much more, though, than that ought to be enough. Some say he is a bear descended from the great and ancient bears of the mountains that lived there before the giants came.
Mm-hmm.
So this also makes me think, okay, so maybe Bilbo really did see giants.
Yep.
Right? So that's kind of interesting. And also later, Gandalf references those giants as well.
That's right.
So maybe a little, I was skeptical of that when we came to that part in the book, and now I'm thinking maybe it was legit giants. And that Bilbo saw correctly. Others say that he is a man descended from the first men who lived before Smaug or other. And this made me think of, I just got done reading Children of Húrin. And there is a massive character in Children of Húrin named Beor.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Does Beorn come from Beor?
Wow.
It just made me wonder.
Yeah.
Because he was a man who lived in the, he didn't live in those lands. You know, it was further west that eventually, you know, sinks.
It's all still changed,
but you think of words and think of names.
It could be the same. Yeah,
you think of names that Tolkien uses and how they're so intentional. The difference is like so striking that I wondered to myself. So if anyone has knowledge on that, I would love to hear. So anyway, we just get this little background on him, right?
Well,
and that he's not to be trifled with, my friend.
He's not to be trifled with, and also don't mess with his bees, okay? This guy, look, here's the thing. We're told that he's bitter, but he's awful sweet. He's actually awful sweet.
Aww.
Not on them dwarves, and not on that hobbit, and not on that wizard, but on them ponies.
And not on them goblins, either.
Definitely. Not on them goblins, but he is on them ponies, okay?
And he loves them ponies.
His dogs, and what else does he have there? He's got several other animals. He loves his animals. So he's sweet on them, and he takes care of his bees. He has literally, it says, bee pastures.
Yes.
I forgot, like, honestly, this is one of those chapters that I actually forget reading. And so when I read it, I was like, and I'm just being honest, like, it's not one that I remember a whole lot of, and I'm like, I remember a big scary guy who was a bear. And I go, who was this guy again? Yeah. I mean, I'm just being like from, I'm talking like way back and even like when I reread it in high school.
Yeah.
It's just one of those.
I have a question for you. Like, I think that other people have made this point before, but I don't remember when I've heard it or, you know, whatever it was. Did you get major Tom Bombadil vibes this entire chapter?
Not major ones, but I definitely, he is like an anomaly. He's like this weird kind of,
yes, he's definitely unknown. He's powerful.
Yes.
They stay in his house, but they have these really bad dreams. Okay. That happens in Tom Bombadil's house. He's there, but he's not there. There's always food for them. They're singing a lot. They're in and out of sleep and rest. It made me think so much of Tom Bombadil and in the house of Tom Bombadil that I almost started wondering if Beorn and Tom are the same person.
Damn. Wow.
Like that's a bridge too far, but like it's crazy to me. It seems, and you almost cemented it right there when you said, I don't really remember. This is a chapter. It's kind of forgettable. In other words, I don't really remember reading it. How many people say that about the Tom Bombadil section of Fellowship of the Ring?
Yep.
They're like, it's forgettable. I don't get why it was there unless you love Tom.
Right.
So I just think that he is a very similar character. And even at his placement in this story, kind of halfway, you know, beginning third of the book, early on in the journey, provides a lot of help. I mean, without them, they're starving, they're wandering. They definitely wouldn't make it through Mirkwood. So he's a huge aid. Demands that his ponies come back. That's also a lot like Tom Bombadil.
That's
true. Exactly.
Well, actually,
like Tom Bombadil.
Oh my God! No, Lane! Oh my gosh, dude! When Gandalf later on will call back from the hill, he's on the far hill. Like far away in the horizon, like almost like Goldberry and Tom when they waved goodbye to Frodo in the Hobbits.
Don't stray off the path.
Yes. Yeah. But he does a final, Gandalf wanted that last word, and he's elevated and he calls back to them and almost like it's a final whatever, but it's from a distance and it felt very much like Goldberry.
And the thing about that too is that Beorn is there in the shadows. He's there with them the whole time.
Yes.
Until they go. And not very trustworthy of them. Also, like, he questions their story the whole time until he goes and finds it out for himself. And then even then, he follows. Like, he doesn't totally trust them. If he trusted them, he wouldn't follow them to make sure that they released his ponies back to him. Like, he doesn't trust them all the way.
Lane, this is good, dude. I like this because he's a slightly dangerous guy, right? And so you're almost like...
Yeah.
Gandalf... Okay, first of all, Gandalf are freaking all, you know how much I love Gandalf, this wizard.
Yeah.
Goes in there and says, nah, we're going to have to walk up on this guy 2x2. And Bilbo goes, like, I totally see why we have to do that.
Like, so if Gandalf is cautious, it's another level, man.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. And if Gandalf was intrigued on his way back and he went and saw Tom Bombadil, they had a great conversation. But, like, it makes you think that as an author, when you're writing, you have devices and you have chapters in your story, that maybe the spirit of this character, what he was trying to do in The Hobbit, he said, you know what? I want to amplify that, and I'm actually going to do something very similar to that in The Lord of the Rings, and he does.
Yes.
I get
and
that.
I think the reason they're similar characters in that sense, too, is they're like spirits of nature. So they're kind of more animal than they are human, and that's why they feel a little more wild or testy or just peculiar and strange, right? It's because we are fully people, right? And for the most... part, even our characters that aren't people, they're dwarves, they're hobbits, they're like, they're humans, you know what I mean? Like, they're not animals, they're not like wild creatures, they belong in civilizations and cultures and all this stuff, right?
Yeah.
So but people like Beorn and Tom, they're outliers. They're not a part of a culture, they're not a part of a community other than nature, Mother Nature itself. And there aren't many rules in Mother Nature. Like, people set up rules, people set up regulations, we set up laws, all these things. But nature, if you want to eat something, you go eat it. You're not going to jail for killing an animal that you ate. You know what I mean? Like, there are no rules in nature other than, like, the fittest survive. Like, the fastest and fittest survive. So that's their domain. That's their community. That's their culture. And I think that's why they feel a little more dangerous or like unsettling to our characters when they encounter them. Whether it's Tom having no, you know, the ring having no effect on him, or Beorn, like the threat that, you know, if you encounter him when he's a bear, he could probably just, you know, eat you up without even thinking about it.
Well, it you know, I mean, even as Yennefer is talking to him, he seems like a dangerous guy. And I do just want to mention that when they first go in to the gate and they travel down there, it is sort of it's beautifully described. This hedge. Oh my God, that's right. They cross a hedge. Just like they do before they go into the old forest.
Old forest, yeah.
You're totally 100% right. Their parallels are, I'm sorry, now they're jumping off the page here at me. That's wild. Get it? It's wild. Wild. I wasn't actually trying to be funny, okay? I was just saying.
All right, well, it's almost like maybe like Beorn was his warm-up or I don't know. I think you're right. I think they're just similar to vices. They're similar types of characters.
Yeah.
That Tolkien... I think Tolkien like really tried to figure out how to represent nature, like to personify nature. Beorn is one of those.
Yeah.
Tom Bombadil is another one of those. Treebeard is an idea of that. And, you know, Beorn's an animal, right? Tom, we're not really sure what he is. He kind of seems like just this spirit of the forest almost. And Treebeard is like, you know, the Ents are like if trees could walk around and talk and interact with you. So, yeah, they're all in the same, I guess, like the same umbrella of character, right? They're like spirit type animals.
Yeah.
Animal character things. I don't know. Yeah.
Yeah, there's a lot of similarities, and I just hadn't thought about those two.
Even the honey being gold, goldberry, you know.
Yeah,
the absolutely. Flowers, the water lilies, or whatever. What's he getting for goldberry? Lilies?
The lilies, yeah.
Yeah, and so I mean the flowers. Bees need flowers. I mean it's all nature themed as well. But
And everything around Beorn here, like his dwelling is they're sitting in this. I forget what they call it, but it's like a really fancy, well done up, like fancy but wild at the same. Yeah, his hall kind of place. And
also
so,
it's also like there are beds set up.
Yeah.
That happens at Tom's house. Yes. There are beds prepared.
Well, there's
how or why, we don't know.
There's a story there like the storytelling begins. Gandalf is telling the story.
Yep.
You know, like the hobbits with Tom Bombadil, they fall asleep and Tom is telling them all sorts of stuff, right?
And they start singing without even realizing it. Remember that in Tom's house? The other thing too is that Beorn eventually becomes very like Once they break him down and that bear shell kind of wears off, like he's very amused by them. Like he thinks their stories are hilarious. That's also, I think, something that is very, very much like Tom, like thinking the hobbits are comical, right? Like they're kind of amusing and that they're almost like there for his entertainment to a certain extent.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, I was definitely getting vibes of, I was getting Tom Bombadil vibes big time this chapter. It felt good, honestly.
Yeah, no, for sure. It is definitely for me at the I didn't get that vibe, and I really had no correlation to the Lord of the Rings series until it was the ponies returning and Gandalf saying goodbye, and they were leaving. That's a direct goodbye versus Beorn's kind of still traveling, doesn't say anything, so the goodbye shifts to Gandalf. But still, that was a very similar structure to what happened to them, and so
yeah. And dude, even getting into the story structure as well, right? So like the Barrow Downs, they're almost like they almost meet it. They almost bite it right there.
Yep. Yep.
Same almost happens in Mirkwood.
Yes. Yeah.
Like they almost bite it. Like you're reading in Mirkwood and you're like, or the next chapter, Flies and Spiders. And actually, honestly, when they're all wrapped up, it's a lot like when they were in the Barrow Downs.
Yep, they're captured. And Gandalf's not there. Yeah,
Gandalf's not there, and it's only Bilbo who can save them. It's only Frodo who awakes that can save the hobbits.
Right.
And, I mean, they're wrapped up in, like, mummification, like they're getting like they're in a tomb. So that's, I don't know, it's very interesting, the similarities there.
Yeah, I love that, man. That's actually really cool. I like it. Well, we'll see.
Is it actually cool? Did I actually do something cool? Is that
what you're saying? It's one of the, I'm so surprised that I You know,
I love that people think we're actually friends. Isn't that cute?
I know.
All right.
You guys wouldn't believe
a couple of prancing ponies.
Sometimes
here.
I joke about the hate mail that I get, and it's actually just lame. It's like crazy. And what's funny about that is it's actually true.
How many burner accounts?
Burner account I got over here. Like,
I'm a troll.
Wow. Something else so let's get into real quickly. I want to get into this conversation with Gandalf, where Gandalf basically is talking to Beorn, and once he introduces himself, one of my biggest things back in the day, and I do remember any time that Radagast is mentioned.
Oh yeah,
I lose it, and I don't even really know why. It's just
like
it's
crying,
only,
or just you get excited.
I just go to myself and I say, "There's other wizards."
Okay.
What?
Yeah.
His cousin, you know? Gandalf has a cousin.
Oh, yeah, he does call him cousin, doesn't
yeah.
he? Yeah.
I'm like, well, all right, cuz. That's pretty cool. And then Beorn kind of knows Radagast and
yeah, it's almost like his
good
cred.
People.
Like that's almost how he like if there wasn't that connection, the road's a lot harder.
Yeah.
But
yes.
Because he knows Radagast and Radagast is down,
right?
He's a cool guy. He's the cat to know.
Yes.
Then it's like, okay, so you had 15 dwarves, or you had 13 dwarves. You
right,
said a
right,
couple.
Right.
You know Radagast. I'll give you the benefit of the doubt.
Right, right. And at what point, by the way, too,
big time.
Does this get absolutely ridiculous, though? That
oh, my God, the counting? It's
the
like
counting.
Four pages. And bro, in my too long didn't read, I was going to be like, yeah, so, you know, they have a little trouble with Common Core math. They get in there and, you know, I don't know, the disagreement on carrying versus borrowing, whatever.
Right.
Turns out five pages later, neither one of them can count. There's 15 of them all together, whatever, you know. I don't friggin' know.
Oh,
you got a werebear
man.
In here just trying to friggin' go kill some goblins.
You imagine what Beorn's holding back is like, hold on, this wizard can't count. This wizard can't count. And then he thinks back, he's like, he is on the same thing Radagast is on. These wizards are on the same vegetable, or protein, whatever you want to call it. So I don't know. I thought that was interesting. I do love though. I guess Gandalf knew, and Bilbo sees it, which is that it's enough distraction. He was engaged in the story enough that he basically says, "Okay, I'm gonna use that to distract you as I bring up two more." And by the end, he's like, "Okay, you got a lot of dwarves. You got a lot of them." Just finish the story. Just finish the story. Tell me what's up.
And all the don't give me your service. I don't need your service. Like, I just want the tale to be done here. Let's get to it, because they, you know, it's just so funny. Like the ceremony that the dwarves always have, the bowing low and sweeping their hoods and their cloaks out of the way, and it's funny. The little troop. Yep.
And honestly, it goes by, and we already know the story, and that's where I felt like it was very straightforward. It is just it's Gandalf showing his cleverness. It's a recap. Yep. It's a recap of what happened. And it is, again, a reintroduction of all of the dwarves. You know, just kind of going through, you know, actually, one of the cool things was that Beorn knows Thorin, and that he is also the grandson of Thor. Right.
Yes.
And then, right. So that was kind of cool with Thrain, and he went through the whole line. And so that was pretty neat. And then we get, you know, Philly, Killy, Oin, Gloin, and so on. And, we get all of them. Bomber is refusing to wait 5 minutes and rolls up and says, I'm here. And it's 3-2. But, as you say, though, he's happy that they were anti-goblin.
Yes.
And that they were anti-warg.
Yes.
Right? You know?
Oh, yeah.
So, and don't never forget.
No, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Well, you're good. I was going to talk about, I was going to make a really ridiculous reference to wargs and not starting the fire, but it's okay. We're
good. Oh, wow.
I like to take you back down memory lane sometimes to some of the
Hey, I see what you did there. Memory lane.
I got
all
it.
Right.
I
get
sorry.
It.
I misspoke.
You didn't even know.
Memory lane.
I do love that. I love that that Beorn kind of alludes to this whole idea that, you know, I guess as he's counting and as he's telling the story about the wargs and everything, that, you know, he would have given them more than fireworks. And we already get this kind of idea that that he is going to disappear and he is going to go kick some butt. And yep. that if this is true, that means that they're encroaching on his lands, essentially, right? That this is a territory that he kind of, much like the old forest, right? That he sort of procures and defends and tries to watch over. And that if wargs and goblins are entering into it, then he needs to go see to it. If this, and he needs to find out if it is really true, because it could eventually threaten his own existence.
No, that's a good point. Yeah,
maybe the abundance that he enjoys. Like, you know, he's got bees and he's got animals that he takes care of.
Oh my gosh, that's another creatures, my God, that's another Bombadil connection. He had dominion over this land. This was his land, and he did patrol it, and he was essentially ruler over it. Mm-hmm. And you knew that if you crossed his territory. So
Beorn goes and keeps the goblins and wargs in check, and Bombadil talks to trees and tells them to let go of hobbits. You know, it's just they are in charge. They're the bosses. But I guess in that way, it is kind of, that's why he's scary, right? That's why Beorn and why Bombadil are scary, because it's like, you don't necessarily know the rules by which they operate. You don't, and that's nature. It's like, so what am I doing that they might not like? And I think essentially sometimes that you can kind of think of, like, to a lesser extent, you think of whatever religion you are, you think of your creator. Like, what am I doing that probably isn't very pleasing, that I like kind of justify, but wouldn't make, you know, the one in charge very happy. You know what I mean? And that's why it's scary, because it's like, well, I've justified it and I've seen reason for it and I'm okay with doing it, but it's probably not very right. So it's just like, it seems like a day to day. Are you going to be on Beorn's bad side today, or are you going to be on his good side? And how do you stay on the good side, and how do you figure out his mind? And you really can't. Like, that's the beautiful thing about these characters, is you can't totally understand how they reason, because they're their own things, man. They're above.
Yep. Yeah, no, that's a good point. And so you're on edge a little bit with this character, and
the whole time. I mean, to the point where Bilbo's having nightmares.
That's right. Yeah.
About being ripped apart by a big black bear.
That's right. He is. He's on guard. Well,
not the kind that have been in your DMs either. I mean, just like an actual bear.
I know that. I know. Okay, and this was scary as all get out. both are terrifying. Just kidding. The terrible forest of Mirkwood. Yeah. What? No. So let me recover here. The dwarves. So you mentioned the sleeping, and you mentioned the nightmare. Mm-hmm. Bilbo gets woken up at one point. He the nightmare keeps him up too late. He falls asleep. He's missing breakfast and things like that. They get, did I miss the part where the dwarves took a bath? I did. That was the very beginning of the chapter, wasn't it? Remember that?
Crap. I don't remember that.
I totally
meant to. Is that before they eat?
Yeah, maybe it is. Because remember that part where they're out there and they're still sore. They're still sore, but they actually get all rested up and they have some food, and that might've been at the beginning, but either way, I was thinking,
In the river, right?
In the river, yeah.
When they were with the eagles? That might be with the.
I think that was in the beginning. I missed that. I missed it, and I meant to bring it up because again here they're eating again, and this is more of a rest for them. As Gandalf said, when they were going in here, they needed this. He knew that they needed this type of rest, and I always think about in Lord of the Rings, Fellowship, Two Towers, Return of the King. Whenever the longer we went on, the less stories we had, or not stories, songs. Yes. The less songs we had.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
gets so more and more actually, serious. So they actually, in this, we come back with a song. And it seems like songs show up during a time of rest. You know, after you've been rested, the joy is coming back. And when things get dire and harder, you see less of the songs. And when traveling on the road even gets hard, you might get one a chapter, but not really. As many, some were in the fellowship, they were loaded. We had tons of songs.
Yes, big time.
So I thought that's another device that he uses, you know.
Yeah, like you're starting your journey. You got a lot. Think about on a road trip. You're playing tons of music. You're singing at the very beginning. Think about when we went down to Texas, right?
Oh,
like 15, 18 hours in, you're like, you're not listening to music anymore.
Right.
You're having really weird, strange conversations.
Yeah.
You're trying to say things to get each other to react and laugh because you're trying to stay awake. It gets dark. It gets dark. There are things I've said to you, you've said to me that we would never want anyone else to hear. And that's okay. Like, that's okay. That's part of the journey. There's lots of things that happen on this adventure, I'm sure, that they don't want getting out. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It happens when the time for singing has kind of ended and they're no longer on that happy. But yes, you get these little, you're right, like hiatuses every once in a while where it's like they feel refreshed, they feel safe again, and that joy comes back and they're able to sing.
Yeah.
And I do love, too, this is interesting because what brings on this song, it's so interesting. Again, this place is magical. Do you care if I read some of this?
That's fine. Here, yeah. Yeah.
Whether it was magic or not, it seemed to Bilbo that he heard a sound like wind. Doesn't say he feels any other indication of wind, because of course they're in this house. So the hall is beautiful, right? There's these pillars, and there's big hearth and fire, and then this just open like chimney where you can look out and you can see the starlight. It's where the smoke goes up, but you can also, you know, see outside to a certain extent and hear outside. A sound like wind in the branches, stirring in the rafters, and the hoot of owls. Soon he began to hear. This is where I think of Tom Bombadil's house, man. Soon he began to nod with sleep, and the voices seemed to grow far away until he woke with a start. That is so much like an enchantment, almost like an enchanted slumber. The door creaks and cracks, and Bjorn's gone. All right. Same thing happens. Tom disappears, comes in and out, and goes, where is he? I don't know. Goldberry's got an answer for him. You know, he's out.
Right, right.
But when this happens, the dwarves are all sitting there cross-legged on the floor, and they begin to sing. And what they sing about is the wind. This whole song.
Yes, that's true.
Is about the wind.
Yep.
And if you just kind of read through it and you sing it, you're like, oh, it's all about exactly what Bilbo is not really sure whether he's hearing or not. Is it magic? Is it not? Does that wind somehow possess them to sing about wind? Are they just inspired by what they hear? Do they recall a story or a song about the wind because they're surrounded by it? And how this song gets like progressively like darker too, doesn't it? Is this about smog? It's about the past the mountain barren swept above the dragon's hair. There black and dark lay boulders stark, and flying smoke was in the air. It left the world and took its flight over the wide seas of the night. The moon set sail upon the gale. It's just this voyage of the wind. It's this adventure that the wind takes, and then it goes right where they're going.
Yeah,
so
it goes
maybe
right
this
where
is
going.
Maybe this
okay.
is the story that the wind outside is telling. Maybe this wind has been to Smaug, and it's foretelling what they have. I don't know. I get tripped out because it's a magical place, man. Right? Like they've been drinking mead. Who knows what's in that mead? Who knows how old that mead is?
Oh yeah, come on.
Mead
now.
Is trippy anyway, dude. It's honey based. People don't drink it very often,
right,
unless you're Travis Sigler. Like,
right,
nobody really drinks mead because it's a strange drink.
Yeah.
And it's delicious, but it's freaking strange, okay?
Yes,
it's
yes,
weird.
Yes.
Wow, I just realized the allusion I made to this leather gum, weird leather.
yeah.
So, anyway, it's bizarre. So they sing this song, and then Bilbo also gets sleepy. Gandalf stands up. It's bizarre. Gandalf stands up and says, it's time for us to sleep. Now, Ez, is that a suggestion or is that a word of command?
That is.
Is he putting them into sleep or were they going to sleep anyway?
No, it was a word of command. Because Gandalf, and this is, you know what, that's actually a really good point. I almost missed it. May have been even one of the first times where we see it. Used in its full power, which is basically to say we
very
need
subtle
to sleep.
Yeah.
And he tells them to go to sleep. Would it have happened anyways? Was he probably doing some wizardry?
Maybe.
Can he control the wind? I don't know. He can't control the rain, but maybe he can control the wind. I don't know.
Okay.
He's close with the eagles, who fly on the winds.
Yeah.
So yeah, no, it is time for us to sleep. Not for Beorn.
He's gone.
He's got his own thing to do, and that's
he left before.
Right. Yeah. He's out doing his thing, changing skins and so on. This is werewolf stuff. I mean, this is just like straight up.
Werebear.
He's So, and that's where I was getting to the point where that all goes down. It's very magical, and it reminds you of the beginning of the, Far Over the Misty Mountains when they were originally singing back at Bag End.
Yeah,
and. Yeah. Yeah, it is kind of a trippy. It's a trippy little moment. Lots of magical stuff happening, but I also feel like they're getting. It's what Gandalf wanted them to do, which is to get this rest in this lodging and to be prepped and fresh to move on. Because they talk about the heaviness of their packs, like the abundance, I guess that is surrounding Beorn and his place and stuff is like that. They need that to carry with them into a place where they're not going to have a whole lot. Later on, so
yeah,
definitely. That's kind of the whole point of it, yeah.
And it's all really rich stuff too, like honey and cream, and it's stuff that would sustain you for a long,
making me tired,
long time. Yeah. It puts you to sleep, right?
Put you right to sleep.
It also, like, think about like how rich honey is. Honey gives it. It never goes bad. Did you know that honey never spoils?
Yeah,
if it's kept correctly, it's the only food that does not spoil. I think they have found honey that's been sealed up in Egyptian pyramids that is still edible.
Lane, I've got some that's it's a 1457 batch that my great
you found at Oak Island.
He harvested.
Was it in the money pit? Did they find it in the money pit?
At the time, these bees were migrating from Scotland
my God.
To the United States.
They actually made
the honey on the Mayflower.
I'm actually thinking about starting up the name game again because I think I found the perfect name game.
Oh, my gosh.
What do you think about Mostly Inside Us?
Is that in here somewhere?
Oh, yeah. Talking about breakfast.
Oh, yeah.
The Mostly Inside Us podcast.
Wow.
I do think it's funny that, like, this next morning, Bilbo is the last one to wake up.
Yeah.
Like, breakfast doesn't get him up. I do love, too, how, you know, he has that, he gets scared because he thinks he hears a bear prowling outside, or maybe he really does. And he has this fear that this giant bear is going to come in and kill them all. And he dives under his blankets, hides his head, falls asleep again at last in spite of all his fears. I just realized too, this chapter, I'm like, Bilbo is our surrogate like child. Like he is the, if this is a kid's story, he is the kid in this adventure. Like all this is brand new to him. All this, like the stuff that would frighten a kid frightens Bilbo. The stuff that would excite a kid excites Bilbo. He gets called stupid. Like he doesn't know enough. Try not to be a fool if you can help it. You know, he's very, I didn't realize till now that he is very childlike and in a lot of ways, not in every way, but in a lot of ways. And that, like, that's almost what could be a kid's avenue into the story is that relation to Bilbo.
Yeah.
I never caught that until I was like, oh, hiding under the covers.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Well,
we all have that inside of us that has that feeling, right? That we try to like master as we get older, even though. You know, if a bat flies out, I'm under the covers.
What are you going to do? What are you going to do?
Yeah, right.
I've seen you there.
I know you have.
Yeah. you were hogging the covers for me. I don't know what you were doing. But, no, you're right, because, yeah, he does definitely, Gandalf wants to take care of him, is protective of him, and even when he leaves later on, he kind of reaffirms that, like, you know, hope to see you again, and he wants, don't forget, there's more to Mr. Baggins than kind of meets the eye here. So
don't forget what I taught you.
Yeah.
Sonny. Yeah.
So The there was one thing I wanted to mention here with the breakfast. Lane. The ring. So he has the ring.
Yeah.
Okay. And you start to notice that he's picking up on a lot of different things, right? So he's things that, like, a hobbit would be the first up to go get food. He'd smell that food. He'd be on it. Like, his rest and stuff, that stuff more important or whatever. It just makes me think that the ring might be affecting him in ways that I hadn't thought about before. Like, he can hear things. His senses are heightened. He's still a hobbit.
Oh, my gosh. I didn't think about that, dude.
Well, maybe I'm totally just, you know, pulling out. No, that's, you know.
No, like, yeah.
Feathers from
more
my
sensitive
hat.
To a creature like Beorn, even. Yeah, huh.
Yeah, well, it just even like, would the ring try to look at the nightmares and stuff like that? Would it try to do things to make him
play
run,
on him?
To flee, to do whatever? Is it in the early stages of trying to kind of, you know, combat and figure that out?
Holy crap, dude.
Because we got to remember that the ring is, even though at the time he had different ideas, intentions, whatever, it seems to be laying dormant in this book. But when you think about it from the perspective of the Lord of the Rings, and you think about where he turned this into, this device, you think, wow, you could make it work in a couple of these situations where he's acting abnormal or noticing things outside of the norm. So, yeah.
Wow, that's amazing. I like that.
Be cool. Yeah. Okay, so they...
Yeah.
They're talking more about... they have all this. They have the breakfast. They do their whole thing. It's almost like a whole other day goes by, right? And then they go back to sleep. Yeah.
Just it's weird. The smoke rings. He has the Gandalf blows all those smoke rings that are all these colors, and they're chasing each other.
Exactly.
And then he talks about picking out the bear tracks, right?
Yes. Well, so when Beorn comes back in the next morning, he says, "So you're still here?
Yeah.
What are you still doing?" He picked up the hobbit and laughed, not eaten up by wargs or goblins or wicked bears yet, I see. And he poked
little
Mr.
bunny
Baggins.
Getting nice and fat. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Dude, so, Beorn definitely doesn't believe in keto. I'll tell you that much.
No, he does not.
Honey and bread and cream and...
He doesn't need to. He's out there running around like a crazy bear all night long. So
that's true. That's very true.
He's on it. He's good.
And we essentially find out that where he tells where he was very proudly. He had to go see if what they told was true or not. He pretty much interrogates. He catches one of these goblins with a warg and interrogates him and finds out that the great goblin is dead and that they're very upset, and especially with the burning of the chief wolf's nose and the death from the wizard's fire of many of their servants.
Okay, Lane, let's just get right to it. He skinned this warg, and he put this goblin's head outside.
Head on a spike. Yeah.
That's where you're kind of like, okay, this guy is not to be messed with. And you see the danger that he poses.
Yes. And before it was all just kind of this like, well, he can turn into a bear, and you don't even want to see it.
Gandalf might be scaring us. You wouldn't even know.
It's all suggestive, but like we see, I mean, this is a kid's book, right? And we're seeing, hey, there's a head on a spit, and we've seen the damage, and he's very proud of it. He laughs about it. He's like, you know, this is a good thing I've done. We learned that that's where he's been. That's what he's been doing. And he just wanted to make sure that story that they told was true. And he's very happy to find that they weren't lying and that they were honest with him. And again, it kind of bumps them up, and it makes him want to help them in any way that he can.
Yes.
As they go on their journey. So it's again, just another lesson that the truth always helps, even if it's kind of tricky to tell. And even if someone doesn't believe you right away. And So essentially what he does is he gives them all these things for their journey. Right.
That's right.
He
that's right. Food, nuts,
the ponies, the provisions. And he even tells them, he even gives them really good advice on, hey, which way you need to go.
Yes.
He's like, you know, I put a map in the dock because I knew you would want one.
Yeah.
And because I was like, hold on a second. I can't exactly remember where all these places are. But if you look, you know that Gundabad is way to the north and kind of out of the way, but still orc area. If you go down south, you've got Dol Guldur, which is where we know the necromancer is, but not from the story. And we know that old forest road is one that is actually kind of regularly traveled, right? And that orcs have kind of, or goblins have been sort of messing around. But that there's, if you go north and then follow a road, an old, overgrown, disused road east, it leads almost directly to Erebor, if you can make it out to the other side, but you can't leave the path. So he even gives them advice that way.
Right, right.
And what does he say? He says just beyond, oh, sorry, go ahead.
Well, yeah, so it's interesting that they take that path, and it's such a, it's good advice.
It's very old forest.
Old forest, for sure. And
yeah.
And at one point, we'll get there in a second, but Bilbo, he's asking if there's another way. And the, now that I see this map and I see this old forest road and the southern route, you're like, well, is that possible? But it's the goblins and it's everything else that could possibly...
Yeah. And the other thing is timing. Like Gandalf says, by the time you get there, forget being there at Durin's Day. Not going to happen.
Yeah.
And so he says, if you go north, you go too close to the northern mountains, which would lead you, that's goblin territory. If you go too far south, you're never going to make it in time. If you take the old forest road, it's too well traveled and too dangerous. You're going to get screwed. So this is the only path. But the interesting that the danger of Mirkwood is the enchantment, the great drowsiness, and the forgetfulness.
Yeah.
And almost like this suffocating, I think it's depicted perfectly in the movies, just like this almost kind of hallucinatory, I think of like mushrooms giving off these like spores and stuff that would that would make you trip, and it seems like it's something that would happen in the old forest. Like you'd literally lose your marbles because of all the dense ancient like growth and whatever it's given off. And it's just such an interesting thing, right? To be in such a thick forest, which should mean like really fresh, clean air, but because of the nature of this forest, it's the opposite. It's like suffocating and confusing and makes you want to go to sleep instead of making you feel more invigorated. So that's the danger that they're facing.
Yeah.
I do also love that what Beorn wishes them and then what Gandalf gives them is exactly the same. So it happens twice. Luck and courage.
Mm-hmm.
Luck and courage is wished by both Beorn and then like two pages later by Gandalf at his parting. So at both of these characters, Beorn and Gandalf's partings, they wish the same thing on them.
Wow.
Luck and courage.
Huh. That's interesting.
Which one is totally out of your control and the other one is totally within your control.
Yeah, that is interesting. Yeah.
Destiny versus decision there. Like the old age-old thing we've talked about, fate versus fortune.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
Well, and actually, so just in between both of those then, so when Gandalf says that and then Beorn, I wanted to mention this because it seems like it's hard to keep track of time. And I only want to read this one part, and then it's done, and it's only half a paragraph. But it is, let's see. So they rode now for two more days, and all the while they saw nothing save grass and flowers and birds and scattered trees, and occasionally small herds of red deer browsing or sitting at noon in the shade. Sometimes Bilbo saw the horns of harts sticking up out of the long grass, and at first he thought they were the dead branches of trees. That third evening, they were so eager to press on, for Beorn had said they should reach the forest gate early on the fourth day. And it's like, okay, he literally just took us through 4 days, right in three sentences, which he can do. But sometimes we, that gets missed, and I sit there and I go, how long? Because I looked at the map, and I was like, no, wait a second. How long was this? Because I'm looking at the map, and they went quite a distance with him. A distance. And it took us a 4 day, 4 to 5 day journey. It's kind of interesting.
And I think it also kind of shows like the domain of Beorn too, that this is protected area and there's nothing to see, nothing to be afraid of. You're going to see some deer. It's going to be monotonous. It's going to be kind of boring after what you've just been through. You're in a different realm almost in a way.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so one of the latter kind of takeaways for me was that the dwarves actually thought about not returning these ponies for 2 seconds.
Yeah, there. They did. They did. What? Yes, they did.
So that's the big, that's one of the big, we go back to Beorn and the idea that he's helping them and that he found out that their story was truthful. He actually interrogated someone to make sure that they were telling the truth.
Yeah, that chieftain. Yeah.
And I think I've done some, I honestly, right now, I'm not able to even recall it or articulate it very well to our listeners, but there is a, almost like a mistrust with Beorn, like of people and other people and groups of people.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Right? For the treatment of his people and things like that. And so it was important that he be able to trust them and that they follow through and keep their promise. Gandalf did that, and he's saying, like, literally, this would be a very bad move, Thorin, if we didn't simply return the ponies.
Yes.
Now, they do need them. They need them. I mean, they could have greatly benefited from them, but they're not theirs. And
to the point where if Gandalf wasn't there, they probably wouldn't return them.
Yeah, and that was because Bilbo talks about...
I think you're... Yeah.
Yeah, well, he talks about, like, how... He's so worried about the pack that he's going to have to carry. It's so heavy or whatever. Yeah. And then it's all perspective and context and where you're at, because then Thorin says, well, that's a good thing now. Wait till the days where you have nothing on your back and you're going to be wishing you did.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And you're like, wow, okay. These guys have traveled. They've traveled before. They know that it starts off heavy and you hope it stays that way until the end of your journey because you're well provisioned. But anyways, it was just interesting to me because, it reminds me of Tom Bombadil.
That's a great point, yeah.
And then Gandalf is very much about it because they've impressed Gandalf and say, well, what are you going to return that horse? Absolutely he is. He's like, I'm going back that way. I'm seeing you.
I'm not going into the forest, right? Yeah. My path is different from yours. And they have these, there's like what, about a million goodbyes. And you almost have this, you almost get this kind of sense that like Gandalf doesn't really want to leave them. Like there's a part of him that even though he says he's got other business and we know that he really does and he's got other things he needs to go attend to and that it really isn't his quest. He brought all this, you know, this company together, but it's,
well,
I mean, he cares what happens, but it's not his to achieve. And Gandalf does this, you know, Gandalf does this. Gandalf builds people up so that they can achieve quests. You know, I guess ultimately it goes back to the role of the Istari, right? That it's they take the guise of old men so that they don't become kings and conquerors and war like these figures that are the ones who make these great accomplishments, right? That they empower others. That's the whole purpose of them. But you do get the sense that like he almost doesn't really want to leave. He keeps saying goodbye over and over again. Goodbye then, and really goodbye, you know, and Thorin's even grumbling at him, very comforting you are, you know, telling us you know, that this really is the only way and that any other way is screwed and that even this way is not gonna be easy. Thanks so much.
Yeah.
Goodbye, be good, take care of yourselves, and don't leave the path.
Right.
Yeah, and then eventually they're just saying, get out of here, you know, goodbye and go away. This is something that Tolkien does that, you know, just alluding to the future, now began the most dangerous part of all the journey. Like, we've been through some crazy stuff, and he's letting us know this next part is the most dangerous. Like, we haven't even. So they fill up their water, right? At the last like clean spring, I guess they've already done that, but they're just shouldering all their packs and they plunge right into the forest and start this most treacherous part without their wizard, man.
Yeah.
The one who could help the most,
right.
Who's helped them out of every jam they've been in so far, except for Bilbo. You know, Bilbo has helped to some extent, but ultimately it's always been Gandalf.
Yeah, and this is where, and you need that moment, and this is, it's a cool structural thing, which is where, okay, he has to go, he's lingering, and he does say, take it all the way back to the beginning of the book, when he says that this will be most interesting for me. He's very interested in seeing it through, and because he sets it up, and he organizes it, he's the orchestrator of it, and then he's got to leave it to be, and leave it to do its own thing, and that's tough because there's a high risk that they may not make it. So, yeah.
Hey, dude, if a goblin played an instrument, what would it be?
Why are you being serious here?
It'd be a stringed instrument because he'd have to be an orchestra.
Oh, wow. You know, did you make that up because you made
just
that up?
Just off the
you?
Spot. Off
you
the
made
spot.
That up. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Because yeah. I think Rebecca Rodney would say to you, she in defense of string instruments, she would say there are also horn, there are also brass and woodwinds and percussion in the orchestra. Okay.
Well,
but that was really good, though.
She didn't play in my orchestra. Okay.
That was pretty good.
Or your orchestra.
Can you imagine if Rebecca played with us in orchestra, she would be like, first of all, she'd be first chair. She would never,
1,000%.
She'd be out there on the front line saying, guys, you have no idea. These guys were such rascals in orchestra and don't trust a word they're saying right now.
You know what, though? I also
this
think
is all
she would.
Scripted. All
I think
scripted.
Back in the day, she would have been like, you know what? That last chair viola and that out in the hallway cello, they're good players, all right?
Yeah.
So I don't care what any of you say or you or right. you. I'm sticking up for them.
Right.
That's Brodo Swaggins and Gandy the Mandy.
Right. But then privately she says, listen, when there's a rest, I need you to not actually play notes. And I'd be like, oh, gosh.
Do either of you know how to read music?
My bad.
Read what? Music?
My bad. Bass clef, I can.
I can't read words.
Oh, gosh, man. So
yeah, bro, that was a great chapter, man.
Yeah, that was good. I it is fun. It's an interesting one. And I'm sitting here spinning and thinking about the Tom Bombadil connections. Those are cool.
Yeah.
Those are really neat, actually. I like that a lot. So, yeah. Well, all right. Well, my friend, shall we venture on here?
Yeah, I think there's only one way. There's only one way, and that's forward. We've got the Bywater Post. Are you able to find the one?
Mm-hmm.
Can you pull that up while I read another one?
You better believe it.
We got this one kind of recently, and I'm gonna fully confess I did read this one before. But I want to say that I wanted to bring it to this episode because I did find it so humbling and inspiring, and I feel like it could probably help a lot of people at this time. It's I mean, they're all beautiful. This one just really it was very touching. So this is from Alex W. Lane Inez. I've been wanting to tell my story for a while now. I finally mustered up the courage to do so, and I want to share something with you both as well as all the uppers. It isn't necessarily my Tolkien story as much as it is something I'd like to get off my chest. I have had a small circle of 5 or 6 friends who live and breathe Tolkien from junior high school all the way. Whoa, just lost it. Sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry.
All the way to. Let me start that over. I have a small circle of 5 or 6 friends who live and breathe Tolkien from junior high school all the way to now, as we all enter our 30s. The board games, the video games, the books, the movies, it's a huge part of our lives. Every year we celebrate Bilbo's birthday as well, watching all the extended editions of Lord of the Rings and the Hobbit films as we stuff ourselves with food and drink. We laugh and enjoy it, just like I'm sure all Tolkien lovers do. Tolkien is so important to all of us and is a huge reason why we even became friends in the first place. So he's incredible fellowship of his own, man.
Yeah.
I've been listening to your podcast since the beginning, although you'd already put out a few episodes, so I came into it a little later. I was an avid listener and did so religiously every 2 weeks up until March of 2019. Myself, as well as a few others, had every intention of coming to LEP2, and then on March 23rd at around 2 a.m., I got a phone call. I honestly couldn't believe what happened, and honestly, it's still hard to comprehend a year and a half later. One of my close friends, Tyler, had been in an accident and had passed away not long after the emergency services had gotten to the scene. Our fellowship was broken. A whole community was lost, and I couldn't believe that this was really happening. Fellas, I went into a really dark place after this. I started drinking heavily every night just to forget and get out of my head. I stopped taking care of myself and lost sight of my goals, family, everything just stopped. My girlfriend, we've been together since 2016, and in November of 2018, the best thing in the world came into my life, a beautiful, healthy baby boy, Jensen Alexander. He gave me purpose. He was my lighthouse guiding me to shore. I have never been more proud and happy in my life. But I stopped being a good father and good partner because I was so messed up internally. I shut everything out and everyone out. I came close to suicide multiple times and lost sight of my faith, questioning why God would do this to me and to us. It was so bad that my girlfriend almost left me. She had everything packed into her vehicle, told me to say goodbye to Jensen. I thank God every day for her not actually leaving, because I honestly feel if I would have lost her and my son, I wouldn't be writing you this now. I stopped listening, watching, reading, and playing anything Tolkien or Lord of the Rings related. It would immediately remind me of Tyler, so I cut everything off cold turkey, including an unexpected podcast. We had planned on coming to LEP2, and obviously after everything went down, I couldn't bring myself to make it there, unfortunately. But when you released all three parts of LEP2, and I saw them in my feed on Spotify, something told me it's time. I listened to all three back to back, crying and laughing and wishing I was there. Tyler was only 28. He was an amazing friend that I'd grown up with, and he was like my little brother. That's why I've always compared our relationship to Pippin and Merry. I know Tyler was somewhat depressed after losing his younger sister in 2016 to another car accident, and then losing his father the following year to a heart attack. He was lonely, and I reached out as much as I could, and we still hung out, but it wasn't like it used to be. Work and my family and newborn took the front seat, which is what happens in life, as most of you know. I'm sharing all of this with you because I want you to know how much this podcast means to me and in a lot of ways saved my life. I'm in a much better place now and have accepted he's gone, although I wish he was still here with us. I know God works in mysterious ways, and he knows why Tyler was called home, and I look forward to the day we meet again on those white shores. It's funny that Tyler would always follow me, always has since he was young, since we were young. Now he's gone somewhere that I can't follow. Thank you for all you both do. I'm sure, and I know there's a lot of uppers who agree how much this podcast means to us. I love you both, and I look forward to hopefully being at an event in 2021. And then he's included a picture of Tyler below. Thank you again from the bottom of my heart.
Wow.
So, Alex, we love you too, man. I found this story moving. I know it's not really, it's like you said, it's not really his Tolkien story, but it's something that happened within his own fellowship, man, to a lifelong friend, and a friend who he shared a love of Tolkien with.
Yeah, man. That is, I love you too, Alex. The thing is, you know, like writing that though is sort of like, and us talking about this here on the podcast, hopefully, God, Lane, you said it earlier, and I didn't quite realize what you were saying, but like, if we're able, you know, because we try to share our little fellowship, you know, with other people, and we want either people who don't have a fellowship or you have one yourself to come on along for an adventure and for a journey and to get away a little bit. God, that is something else. I mean, it's just, I think
the part for me too, man, is thinking about, we don't know what goes on in other people's lives. You know what I mean? We know to a small extent what happens in each other's lives. We know as much as two friends can know, but there's so many moments in between where it's just us. And like, I, cause it's just interesting. I see little pins in here, like LEP2. Like, I remember what I was doing around that time. You know, I remember who I was around that time. And to think, and to go back in time and think about things that have already happened in Alex's life and things that were happening in his life, and that around that same time that he was experiencing and dealing with this massive tragedy of losing a friend, it just makes me think, like, what's going on right now?
Yeah.
What's going on right now with people who might enjoy the podcast who listen? Like, and Tyler, Alex, your friend there is, your brother is speaking right to me, man. But it makes me, it inspires me. That inspires me and motivates me to, on day, because to be honest, as there are days where I don't feel like podcasting.
Yeah.
There are days on when you come over or we do Zoom and I'm like, I just want to sit here and talk to Ez.
Yeah.
I just want to have Ez all to myself. I want him to have all of me to himself.
Oh, yeah.
And I just want to hang out and I don't want to record. And then I read this and I think every time we can record, we need to know that even if it's just for Alex,
come on.
Even if it's just for Alex, man, we got to keep going. We got to keep releasing episodes. We got to continue through the books.
Yep.
We've got to continue being ourselves.
Yep.
And not changing who we are or how we do things, because to, even if it's just Alex, and to people like Alex, it means a lot. And even though I can't understand that, I don't understand how it does.
Yeah.
That doesn't matter.
Nope.
Like, what matters is, I don't know, man. The fellowship is there. The friendship is there. And that Alex is more than worth it, you know?
Yeah. So. Yeah, Lane. So, like, if I didn't know that saying good morning to a certain person every single day lifted their spirits up or whatever, but I it's just something that I do. It's in my nature. It's who I am, and I just do it. And that makes them feel good. And they never say anything to me about it. But, like, sometimes there's good being done or there's things that are happening that you'll never know about. We'll never have somebody send in something or never reach out. And that's okay. We're totally okay. Like, that's fine. But if it is doing some good and it's just by us being ourselves, that's great. And then also those people then hopefully are, again, like the positivity spreads and you're doing more. And fellowship is the key word in what he's saying here, which is having fellowship with one another and us all experiencing this life together and like moving through it. And struggling, it's hard, it's not easy, and then sharing that and being open and honest and just being authentic, like I think it's what it's about. It's a great journey, it's a great adventure, and it means a lot to me that people write that we got this, because it truly does for me anyways, especially after this. I it is just to bed, put it to bed. We're doing it. It's what we do. We love doing it anyways. It's almost like it's just, we naturally do it. You and I would be doing it anyways. And so, the crazy thing is that we then just now make more time to kind of do our own thing on the side and Lane and Ez just, we got to get up to, we got to get up to our shenanigans. We got to get our mustard sauce, bacon just right at the right temperature and just to move on. But it does.
I don't know how that even sounds right.
I know. So I know people out
getting
there
getting our mustard sauce.
Understood exactly what I was saying.
Easy.
But like Alex, I'm telling you, this is the cool. The cool thing is that it. Lane, I'll be honest with you. Since we're gonna be 100% honest, I have thought about my friends and my family, and it does. You always, every time I leave your house, you say, I love you. I love you. And you say it every single time. And I think we need to start saying it every single freaking episode to each other and to the people who we don't even know who are out there. It doesn't hurt me at all to tell people that I love them. And we were talking the other day just about misconceptions and misunderstandings that people may have about us or about people or life or whatever. It doesn't hurt me. Go back to the conversation we had on the way down to Texas, man. Sometimes the enemy, whoever, whatever that is out there, wants to take us down and wants to make us think, try to change the way we, our perception of things in our mind. It doesn't hurt me at all to tell people I love them and just to say, you know what I mean? I'm bigger and stronger and I'm better than that. And thank God that like, my parents, your parents, our friends, our family, that we're blessed and we're able to kind of do whatever we can with the time that's given to us. And it may be, and as my father, who is a minister, tells me all the time, that life is like a vapor, that it appears for a little season, and then it soon vanishes away. And that literally, we don't know beyond this world what we don't. It's the great unknown. It's the adventure. It's life. But while we're here, we do have control over a few things, and we need to make sure that we do the very best, and just the very best. We're not going to be perfect. That is actually the whole point of life, is making mistakes. In the day and age we live in, people are expecting this level of perfection that is just, it's unreal. And it's like, we're teachers. Lane and I teach. We are so invested in the youth and people. We want to see them grow and evolve, and we're going to grow and evolve with them. And it's just like, man, I want to always remind people of that, because even the best of us, who are the furthest along, the most evolved, the most whatever, they've got a long way to go.
Yeah.
That if they don't think that, my friend, then we are far ahead of them. We're way more ahead than I realized, which is crazy. But I don't know. Yeah. So Alex, I just want to say thanks, man, because that is something else. And it, the spirit of your friendship and your fellowship lives on. And it really will. And we're gonna make sure. I look forward to, and I hope that we get to meet you and just absolutely. You know, that spirit carries over. So
yeah. Absolutely. I look forward to the day. Yep.
Whoa. All right. So here we go. We got one more queued up here for you. Yep.
Okay.
All right. Henry S. Hamill. I love throwing in the middle initial, you know. That was just a game changer for me. Not a lot of people do that, Henry, so I like it. Hello, Ezra, Lane, and all. After spending the last year and change adventuring together, it seems high time to share my Tolkien story. And I'll say that Henry might have shared this with us earlier, and we might have either it got buried or what have you. But we get this resent, and we want to make sure that we get it out to you guys. It's really good.
Yeah.
Yeah, it seems fair to share my Tolkien story with you and our wonderful fellowship. It has taken far too long for me to put this to paper for reasons that I believe will become abundantly clear as you read on. I am not going to apologize for the length of this piece. There we go.
That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, we're getting a few lessons across here, yeah. As you have made clear, there is no reason to do so, but it will be quite long indeed. I will, however, preface my story with this. I do not tell this tale to inspire pity or to evoke an emotional response from those who hear it. I am telling this tale for no other reason than to prove a point which I believe to be central to the Lord of the Rings. So without further ado, this is my story. I never read much as a child. Most of my early contact with myths and fairy tales came from movies, television, and oral traditions. I grew up in a world I believe to be ripe with queens, princes, knights, dragons, and other fantastical creatures. My father has always been a lover of fantasy and read The Hobbit to me when I was young. So young, in fact, that I had no recollection of this happening. However, I have been informed of this truth. Isn't that something, right? That's probably like your kids, you know, right? You got that age where dad did that, right? yeah. And it's the only logical explanation for my obsession to this day. There it is. It's like ingrained in someone. Yeah. It's soaked in there from the early days. My true introduction to Middle Earth, as for many others, came from the Peter Jackson trilogy. I was only 7 when the first film came out, and 9 during the premiere of Return of the King. I had an immense fear of movie theaters as a child, stemming from seeing The Phantom Menace at the impressionable age of 4. Now, whether this comes from subject matter of Star Wars Episode 1 or the sheer grandeur of the film in theaters, I will leave up to the listener. Wow, okay.
I hope it wasn't Jar Jar. I just hope it wasn't.
Yeah, you're right, yeah. Therefore, it wasn't until my parents purchased the box set of films that I was able to watch what would become a lifelong obsession. For years, I watched the movies weekly, memorizing lines, songs, and things I knew. All there was to know about the fictional world. It wasn't until later when a close friend grew tired of me, quote, throwing shade at Frodo Baggins, that she convinced me to read the books. So it came to pass that I picked up The Hobbit, which had long sat on our bookshelf, and I devoured it. Sadly, at this time, I went off to college and other pursuits, whether for good or ill, began to fill my life. I didn't make it past The Hobbit until 4 long years later, when my now fiancé and I were planning a post-graduation trip to Europe. While packing, I grabbed the tattered Fellowship of the Ring from the bookshelf, placed it in my bag, and off we went. As we traveled from country to country, I read the books as if they were doomed to disappear from the world the next day. Now, traveling isn't necessarily difficult, but to say it is a simple task would be an understatement of the highest order. Many long, weary days were spent lost in strange cities, trying to understand unknown languages, and walking for seemingly endless miles. Whenever the days became difficult, I would tell myself that if Sam and Frodo can take the ring to Mordor, I can figure out how to find my way without a map or a cell phone. In fact, those days filled with mild adversity were what made for such a memorable and growth-inducing experience. Over the 8-week trip, I read through the entire Lord of the Rings, and my eyes were opened to new layers of a world I thought I already knew. Unbeknownst to me, while I was away, my older brother and only sibling had been suffering greatly from a mental break. A few days after I stepped foot back in the States, he was arrested and committed to a mental health facility.
Wow.
This is something that to this day I have been unable to completely process. The arguably most influential, smartest, and talented person in my life was, in my mind, taken from me. The person I looked up to the very most and an almost godlike figure had been shown to be a mortal man, and I was crushed. The only way I could think of dealing with this was to escape and venture back to Middle-earth once more. So again, I traveled with Sam and Frodo through despair and hopelessness, through shadow and fire, through the altering of everything I knew and held dear, and came to the end of the journey far stronger than the man or hobbit who began it. Repeating the now mantra, if Sam and Frodo can do it, so can I. My brother has since been in and out of mental health facilities for the last 2.5 years. As I said before, I do not tell the story to inspire pity for me or my brother, but to prove a point. Adversity breeds strength and greatness. You cannot have one without the other. Until that moment, and even now, my life has been idyllic, in the same sense that before the hobbits left the Shire, they lived a privileged, beautiful, and safe life in a world wrought with darkness. It was having to leave the perceived comfort of their old lives and face adversity that made it possible for them to grow and become the strong, wise hobbits that they are at the story's end. This leaving one's comfort zone to face a seemingly hopeless and unknown reality, I believe, is crucial to the story and is embodied in the famous line from Gandalf to Frodo. "So do I," said Gandalf. "And so do all who live to see such times. But that is not for them to decide. All we have to decide is what to do with the time that is given us." Life isn't always easy, and things rarely end up the way in which we envision them. But it is this aspect of life that makes it beautiful. It's unexpected, it's difficult, it's lovely, and it's painful. In those moments of pain and despair, we learn to grow and to love the things in which we hold dear, especially the people and nature that surrounds us. So here ends the beginning of my Tolkien story. It is not the true end of my story, for I will forever continue to learn from Tolkien's genius. In the last 3 years, I have made my way through the Legendarium twice. The addition of your podcast to my life in early 2018 has once again shown me a new layer of our world in the Middle Earth, and that I had not experienced before. I am forever grateful for the community you have built around these books, and I look forward to many long years adventuring together. With boundless love and respect, Henry S. Hamill.
Wow.
Yeah. Well, it's been the Bywater Post has been
wow,
emotional today, friends.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Henry, for beautifully written. Thank you for not apologizing for the length as well. Because that is unnecessary.
Yeah.
And also, like, the one of the things that really stuck out to me is that whole process of reading The Lord of the Rings. Maybe that's why this last time when we read it and we got really to the darkest of dark, we just kind of felt depressed.
Yeah.
Is that
yeah.
You feel with these stories in such a way that it, like, really, they really do help you process difficult times. They're therapeutic in a way, aren't they?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
It shows you, yeah, like, if Sam and Frodo can do it, so can I.
Right, right.
What would Aragorn do? You know, right. What would Gandalf say? Like, they help you figure out stuff in life.
Yep.
Or at least be able to cope with them, with stuff that's going on.
It's as he said. I mean, and so Henry said it, and it's this thing where in which, you know, adversity. I mean, even Alex and his fellowship, the adversity that you're faced there life
very
and
similar.
Death, right?
Very
you know,
similar
yeah.
Stories.
And how do you move beyond that? Yeah, how do you go back into the stories? Like now, those hold so much more emotion, and there's so much more going on there for Alex as he goes back into those.
Yeah, to a painful
point. Once again.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, exactly. And then is that's an adversity that one would overcome. It's a different type. And so it's just interesting that these stories can become a tool where in which you you learn and you grow and you face adversities with your characters. You can take that, model it with your life. And I don't know. I think, Henry, you're totally right. There's times where I think to myself, like, I know that right now, where I am, like you talk about things that you could do in life and adversities that you might face. Lord, there are so many that each and every one of us face a different type of adversity, or we have different obstacles laid in front of us. And that's why we need each other. That's why you need a fellowship. That's why you do help each other overcome those things, because they are all different and we all bring different perspectives and different walks of life. And it's important to communicate with one another and to fellowship with one another. I keep saying it, but it's the truth.
Yeah.
So,
and how our stories can help. Yeah. It is wild because, you know, there's often like what we've heard in, Tolkien stories is like a hesitancy to share because there's that fear that like, my experience is either going to be not meaningful enough or too meaningful or too personal or too emotional or not emotional enough. And that there's that fear of people not being able to relate or thinking it's silly or thinking it's too serious or whatever. And it almost always seems to delay people in sharing. But the beautiful thing is once they do share, and I don't think there's anything wrong with that delay. I think that's natural.
Right.
Once they do share, I think it probably does something for them. I think there's probably something cathartic for them. If nothing else, it affects the two of us.
That's the dude. Yeah. Yep. You're darn right.
There's a reason this is what we end with as well, because this is the cherry. Like, this is the tippy top in the words of Ez. Like, this is the whole point of what we're doing. Mm-hmm. The whole point of what we're doing in this podcast is you and me reconnecting our friendship.
Yep.
You know, something that had been lost that was found again.
Yep.
So it all revolves around fellowship and getting to know people who listen and enjoy the subject of Tolkien, but even more so just enjoy the fellowship aspect. So the sharing of that does something for us. And then it affects all countless thousands, thousands, tens of thousands of people who listen to the episode and hear that story are positively affected by it as well. So, yeah, and then I would think, anyway, anyone who's on the fence about sharing theirs, it only gives them courage and emboldens them to want to reach out and send theirs. I mean, evidence is our mailbox. It's overflowing. We have so many Tolkien stories that, like, it'll be years before we're caught up. We'll never be caught up.
Yeah,
We'll end the podcast before we're caught up, like, kind of a deal. We'll have to, our last episode will have to be a bunch of just Tolkien stories that we never got to.
Put them out there but, for the world.
Yeah. Well, but,
Lane, I want to say, you know, like, I don't know. I'll say this. Sometimes we talk, I feel like I talk too long or whatever, but
you never talk too long.
Maybe. Yeah. Okay.
You don't?
Well, this is kind of a crazy thing. Sometimes I meditate about life and I think about it. I sit over there on my step or I get my car and I drive, as you know, or I go to certain places.
I can always tell because I switch over to the, there's a little bit of a break in the conversation, Bluetooth. And then I can tell that I'm in a speaker.
Yeah. Shadowfax is kind of, reorganizing.
Yeah.
Stuff.
Yeah.
But, like, I think about life and it's like, really life is this great big story that is full of it's made up of all of our stories, right? It's whatever people have said it before, but it's true. It's so wild. And what's magical about this moment and this time is that everyone, all of us right now, shared that moment or shared a portion of it together. That is the that is the craziest part. Like, it doesn't matter. You know, think of the biggest celebrity you want to think of or writer or whoever or friend or that person you pass that you literally you've never seen them in your life, a complete stranger. And they might just be no one to you, but there's someone that walks and lives in our world and shares it with us. And I think about that and I go, that is magical. That is actually a magical, crazy thing. That we live in the same world and share it together. And it's shared a shared story.
Yeah,
shared story. It's a shared story.
It's what's crazy. Yes,
so crazy.
Is.
So crazy.
And how when we learn about other stories, I think it only makes ours better. I think it only, whether we fully realize it or not, or whether we process it or how we process it, but it helps us view our story in a more intentional, important way, I think. It helps us take our story more seriously because we see all the different things that happens in all these different people's lives and knowing that, like, hey, anything that we've heard could happen to us.
That's what I literally, I thought that we've heard, earlier.
Yeah.
Thought that.
And vice versa, like anything that's happened to us could happen to someone else. And it's just this idea that anything goes. And I think ultimately what that does is it helps us appreciate every moment that we're given, every moment that isn't, filled with adversity, and even the ones that are, like, that is true. Like, I was just re-listening to our episode with our last year's anniversary episode where we talked to Jeremy Strayer and we talked to my dad. And dude, it was wild. We were talking about their friendship and you had said, you know, that what my dad and Jeremy have is what you hope for us to have someday, you know, that just continued friendship that just builds. And dad said, be careful what you wish for because, you know, real friendship is
built. He did say that.
Is forged in fire, what he said. And he was breaking in tears. And I actually, I know that you're processing things as well, but like I can put my finger on like multiple incidents this past year. Yeah. And it felt strange. I was like, was that prophecy for like what was going to happen in the past year? But you and I have faced like, you know, not, you know, I don't know. It's all relative. But like for us, it was pretty.
It was significant.
It was significant. It was more of a mental thing than anything, but fire.
Yeah.
And it's only made us better friends. But because it was Jeremy who came in. He's like, dad didn't have any words. He was crying, right? And he's broken. And Jeremy's like, it hurts. It hurts. It's not fun. Like when you're going through adversity, it's not a fun thing. Like afterwards, it's great because you're stronger. You're more capable. You're able to handle more things than you were prior. But like during it, it hurts.
Yeah.
And so like, I think of this is crazy, but I think of I know I'm rambling, man, but it's just this is a good one. Maybe someone will hear this and will Robert Downey Jr. got an award like some years ago for some kind of, it was some sort of acting achievement. And he wanted Mel Gibson to present the award to him. Well, at the time and since, Mel Gibson's a very controversial figure. He said a lot of things that he probably wishes he could get back. His family kind of fell apart. But when you and I were kids, he was like sexiest man alive, winning Oscars, directing Braveheart. He was the man.
Right.
And when we were kids, Robert Downey Jr. was not the man.
That's right.
He had a drug problem and he couldn't get acting jobs. And so he said, he's accepting this award, and a lot of people were confused. They're like, why did you have Mel Gibson give you this? And he said, you know, when I was addicted to coke and I was going through rehab and I couldn't get any acting jobs, Mel Gibson gave me work and hired me and saw me as a valuable person. And he told me something something about you hug the cactus. You can decide to hug the cactus and embrace difficult times. And if you hug the cactus long enough, you come out the other side a better person. And I'm paraphrasing. You can go actually look up the speech on YouTube. It's beautiful. And he said, and what you do someday is you help someone along the way hug the cactus. Like you pass it along. And he said, you know, Mel did that for me then. I bet he never thought that I'd be doing it for him here tonight.
Yeah.
But it was just this amazing moment where they, like, you saw how he was helped greatly. And then by him having, you know, by telling this story and by having Mel present this to him, that he was showing that, like, your mistakes don't define you. Your difficult times don't define you. Not even necessarily how you respond to your difficult times. They don't always define you. Yeah. It's like being a human being is a process, and it's filled with ups and downs. And the judgment should be left for others than us. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah,
just wild.
Yeah.
Absolutely wild.
It is a race we run with patience, my friend.
Yeah, man, with patience for sure. Yeah. Yeah, wow. Forged in fire. Wow. Like, when I thought about that, I was blown away. I was like, oh,
that
my
is
gosh,
crazy. I totally, I can remember verbatim your dad saying that, and me sitting there thinking, like, wow.
It's like, wow. We
that's a man
listening.
But I knew that's a man who he'd lived it. They had lived it. It was real. So,
we're out of time anyway, but I don't have any riddles ready.
Oh, no, we're good. We're fine.
So
if we spent time on riddles, we'd be at 4 hours, I think.
Can you imagine? I can't even think. What? How can people share the load as?
Yeah, hey, friends. Absolutely. So again, you can always follow the social media. There is actually a really funny, I'm having a great time with the post. Lords of Song.
Saruman.
It's so good. It is so good. Saruman. And it's just, it's unfinished, untitled, semi-titled, quasi-titled. Projects, and I just love it, and I literally listen to it at work sometimes, and it's great. So that's at UpTalkinTolkien. You can go find that on Instagram. It's there. It's a gem. It's a hidden gem, and it's right there. It's the most recent post as of December 19th on Instagram. So go check that out. Again, over on Patreon, we got some cool stuff. We just sent out the gift packages. We got a Zoom hangout coming up soon here in December. And we're trying to do one of those a month and just hang out with some of our patrons. Have a good time. It is really neat and nice to put a face to a name, hear those voices. It's just great. It's really cool. Been a fun time. So, but you guys can do that. Again, always send in your stories. That's always great. Another way that to help out the podcast is to do that. And honestly, we haven't mentioned it in a long time, but as we get closer to the show and things, if you are enjoying the podcast, and I always say this as kind of a joke, if you're still listening at this point, you either hate us or you love us.
Or you're asleep.
Or you're asleep and you left it on. But
or you used it to get to sleep. I mean, that's fine.
One of the two. Yeah. That's fine. But don't forget, you can leave us a review on iTunes. It does help out the podcast, and that is a great way to share the load, an easy way. Yeah.
Yeah, and some of those have been coming in recently, and they're all, like, very, very kind. So much appreciated.
We appreciate it.
Thank
we
you
really
very
do.
Much. And even the nasty ones are very funny. So we actually get a kick out of those. It's time for Fortnite farewells, formerly weekly well wishes. Yep. I haven't said that for a while. We want to wish a happy early happy birthday to the flannel wizard. Bruh, it's not getting by me. Happy birthday to you. Yeah.
Wow.
Happy birthday to you.
Wow. Sing it, son.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, brother.
Wow, thanks, man.
Just a few days from now, if you want to send the Flannel Wizard some love, December 22nd is his birthday. Blow up that inbox. Send him some DMs, preferably with your shirts on.
Yeah,
and wish him a happy birthday.
Comment on
Christ, the year of Christ, bro. 33.
The year of Christ. Tell me that the salt and pepper is looking okay in the old hair here too. I think it's looking not too bad. So.
You got to become the Gray Wizard somehow.
Well, exactly. I've been traveling.
Gray
hame
or gray hair. You know what I mean? I don't know.
Yeah.
But happy birthday, my man. Thanks, buddy. I love you, dude. And I love getting to do this with you. It's an honor. If we never did it again. It'd be okay too. It'd be sad, but we've been talking about this lately, like just thinking about we've already done so much and that's always there.
It is. It's always there.
What we've done, your Tolkien stories, it's all there and it will always be there. So
it's true.
I don't know, the possibilities are endless. We want to thank you for having a stay with us, though queer and frightful at times. In a fort time, we'll try I can't read. Try not to stray from the path in chapter 8, flies and spiders.
There we go. I'm scared of both of those things, actually. So
flies are gross. Spiders are scary.
I just bugs in general, you know. It's
you don't like flies. You're freaked out by flies.
If you ever notice, I get really just put off. Like one,
you do,
one,
dude.
One's in,
disgusted.
Like I do you remember it was like further up and there was one in the, there was one in your living your dining room and I was like, I can't focus.
Couldn't focus.
I was gone. I was done. I couldn't do. I couldn't do it.
They are strange. They're
I get really concerned about them. So that will be coming up
concerning
for sure.
Concerning flies.
Concerning flies. A new podcast coming your way. So, and if you like this podcast, don't forget to subscribe, like us, write that review, leave a comment, or send us a shadow fax.
We'll see you in a fortnight, and remember, actually, this sign-off is a little shout-out to Bill Joe Baggins. Peace, love, and second breakfast.